phenomenon out of Africa that would summon the people of the village. When you walked into this room, you heard the beats of the ones and the twos. To the contemporary world, again, summoning you to come together to dialogue. And this evening, you're going to have the opportunity to step into the world of Kevin Powell. I thank you for being here, because he is going to deal with some phenomenal issues of today. Thank you.
Again, thank you. In the climate of America, it is imperative that we have this dialogue. And Kevin Powell is no one better than to carry this conversation. While there are many people coming, and I'm sure that this room will fill up shortly, it is imperative that we again have this dialogue and address the issues that face our community. Up next, you will hear from Alfonso Reese, who will introduce our president, who will offer a welcome. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming to the Kevin Powell I Like It, Young America, Hip Hop, and the Power of Voting and Being Woke presentation. My name is Alfonso Reese. I am the president of the Male Empowerment Network, also known as MEN here at Phoenix College. I have the distinct pleasure of introducing the president of Phoenix College, Dr. Larry D. Johnson, Jr. Here are a few things I can tell you about Dr. Johnson. Prior to Phoenix College, he was at St. Louis Community College District. He is a transformational leader. He is a member of the President's Roundtable, the National Council on Black American Affairs, affiliate councils of the American Association of Community Colleges. He has an earned doctorate in the humanities with an emphasis in English literature from Clark Atlanta University, a master's degree in humanities with an emphasis in medieval to Baroque studies, and a graduate certificate in institutional research from Florida State University, and a bachelor's degree in English literature from Florida Agricultural and Mechanical University, also known as FAMU. Yeah. He is a mentor for students from diverse backgrounds. He is a member of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity, Incorporated. But most, he is one who has a passion for students and student success. I introduce to some and present to others, Dr. Larry D. Johnson, Jr., Phoenix College president.
All right. Good afternoon. It's such a pleasure to welcome you all here today. If we can get the students of Phoenix College to stay in quickly, if you're a student at Phoenix College, quickly. Thank you so much for being here. This is great. Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated. And to our distinguished guest, Mr. Kevin Powell, we're so honored and humbled to have you here with us. And to our facilitators, Dr. Camille Westenberg, and to our Dean, Ralph Thomas. Let's please give them a round of applause for helping to coordinate and facilitate. And also to Genesis Toole, I'm not sure if she's here, she's been very supportive. Thank you as well for this magnificent event. So as Dean Thompson and Dr. Westenberg articulated, this is so critical that we be a part of this dialogue, and certainly you students, you're here, and that's important, that you understand the power of your vote. I just witnessed a couple of hours ago the first African-American governor nominee for Tallahassee, Florida, is Andre Gillum, who actually attended Florida A&M University with me, but it does a couple of things for me. It shows you the power of what can happen when people get out and express their voices through voting. So as we're moving into that movement here in Arizona, it's very important to understand what the representatives are saying about what's taking place in this community and what really the essence of that message, so that you can be very versed on what decisions you're making when you go to the polls. So again, we welcome you here. And that's the sixth president, I believe. I think it's the sixth. That's the sixth president of Phoenix College and the first African-American president in this college's 98 years of history. I am so excited to be here. I am so excited for the work that will take place. And I am supported by a great group of deans, a great group of vice presidents who's here. Dr. Crucy, if you would stand, please. She serves as the Dean of Student Affairs. In the back, we have our CFO. If you would please, Mr. Paul DeRose, if you would please raise your hand. Also have here our Director of Advancement, Ms. Deb Spots, if you would raise your hand. And our Vice President for Academic Affairs, Dr. Gakar, in her absence. And we have a host of other leaders who support this great institution. So I cannot do anything that I do without the team that is here. So I believe we're in for a great treat today, this evening. And I ask that you be attentive to the message that will be articulated. And do know that for Phoenix College and for the state of Arizona, the best is still yet to come. Thank you so much.
Hello, everyone. My name is Charlene White, Vice President of the BSU NAACP. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce you to Kevin Powell. Let me let you know more about Kevin. Kevin is a poet, journalist, activist, and public speaker. He is also an author of 13 books, including the critically acclaimed autobiography, The Education of Kevin Powell, A Boy's Journey into Manhood, and also of the upcoming biography of Tupac Shakur, the global hip-hop icon. He is the co-founder of BK Nation, a new American organization focused on civil and human rights for all. In the 2018-2019 academic year, he is a visiting scholar at James Madison University in Virginia. Producer of She, a choreo play about ending violence against women and girls, written and choreographed by his wife, Jenna. Ladies and gentlemen, Kevin Powell.
So as we do in the black church, the next voice you will hear after the rap artist will be that of Kevin Powell. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Mic check. How you guys doing tonight? We good? No. My name is Torrey Masters. I'm an artist from Phoenix, Arizona, and I have a piece I want to present to you all.
Boy, I don't know what you're talking
about.
Yes,
you do. I was 6 years old.
Now, you just listen.
No, you listen to me.
No, I think you done forgot.
I think you forgot. I said listen to me. This is my time. You understand me? It don't matter what you tried to do. You couldn't destroy me. I'm still standing. I'm still strong.
Yeah.
Not always will be.
Dreams falling out the window, I see them. So I'm diving off the 10th floor, I need them. Many ways of superheroes, you need some. But when the time comes, you gotta be one. They say if you got a cape, you a joke. And if you can't scrap, carry it's like notes. And although my melanin ain't bulletproof, I'm still Southside Super Saiyan 2. Fall in love with an ape, you can't escape the truth. I'ma wear it in your hand and bathe it in my shoes. Salute, let's vibe to it.
I tried to drink it away. to put one in the air.
That's the lines on the song, yeah.
I tried to dance it away.
I tried to change it with my hair a little bit. Look, but the imagination happened so fast, I crashed in a beam and transformed into something 100 more. Sierra Leone, the motherland. Look, and I've never been on the motherland. Look, but it's better we own the motherland other than her paradise. Diamonds and oil in her soil, she can save a life. A fairer skinned spirit looked at me and said, can I dive into that ocean over your head? And I told her, don't touch my hair.
When it's the feeling
that I wear, I told her, please don't touch my soul. Yeah.
When it's the rhythm, I know.
Don't touch. What? Yeah. Blood and tears just to get it on me. I conquer fears in 100 men from a broken army. Covered in Armani gold wristwatch. So hip hop, they didn't want me. But they need me, invisible. They never could see me. Believe me, brought me all the way from abandoned land to leave me. My identity was all I can count on. Mama said, never take quarters at the fountain. Yeah. It's the kind of music they make for Grammys, you feel me? That's what we want. And real quick, I'd like to say, look, and sometimes I feel like poetry. And I just wanna flow in thee until she says yes, like flowetry. And I know it's forgery, but I'ma sign your name on these papers. Cause there's no one else that means more than me. You deserve a solid king, all of me. Thank you.
I'm still standing. I'm still strong.
Let's give it up for Torre again. Give him a round of applause. Can y'all do me a favor? Can we all move closer? Like everybody, even if you gotta leave early, just move closer, please. I just wanna be able to see everybody. Can we just move closer, even the people in the back? Let's all the way move all the way down. I'd really appreciate it. How y'all feeling out there? Y'all good? Y'all, can we move closer? Like everybody, please. Because I actually wish I was down there, to be honest with y'all. I wish we were down, I want to be closer. Please, I said please, por favor. Gracias. People are like moving from one seat to the next seat. That's not, they're making horizontal moves, some folks. And the folks over there, can y'all move over to this side? Is that cool? Over here and over here. Can we, please? I mean, I'm about to, I have a new book coming out next week, and I'm about to do a 15-city speaking tour with the book, and we're calling them Intimate Community Conversations, and I just think it's important for us to actually be intimate, be close to each other. There's a lot of division in this country, and I feel like we symbolically represent those divisions when we sit all spread out in a room. Would y'all agree with that? Yes. And I want to be a bridge builder, not a bridge destroyer. Y'all with me? So I want to thank God, first and foremost, for this opportunity. I'm a Christian, but I'm never so religiously arrogant to assume everyone is a Christian. If you're Jewish, if you're Muslim, if you're Buddhist, if you're atheist or agnostic, you have that right as well. I hope that we all can just agree that we're all part of the human family, the human race. Can we agree to that at least? You know? I want to acknowledge President Johnson. Thank you so much for welcoming me here. I was listening to your bio, and I said, you have an incredibly impressive young leader here at this school. And I can tell you for a fact, when I heard Clark Atlanta and FAMU, I got excited because I know so many great folks have come out of those schools. And I just thank you, sir, for having me. Where's Dean Thompson at? Is he Dean Thompson, my fraternity brother? I want to salute him and Alpha Phi Alpha fraternity, my fraternity. Thank you, Dean Thompson. Dr. Westenberg, where is she at? Dr. Westenberg, thank you so much for having me. All the folks who made this possible, who work with the president, the dean, the Phoenix College NAACP, the BSU, the Male Empowerment Network, the Phoenix College of Student Life, the City of Phoenix. I have a long list here I was given. I'm not going to remember everybody, but I want to just say thank you from the bottom of my heart for having me. I go to a lot of colleges and universities to speak, but I need to tell you all, schools like Phoenix College are especially important to me, because I feel like this community college and schools like this represent the real America. That's how I feel. You know, look at the diversity in this room. Look at the beautiful diversity in this room. This is America. As Childish Gambino said, I want to thank my wife, Jenna Parker, who's here with me. Our first time in Arizona, the great state of Arizona, y'all in Phoenix. And we came from New York City. And I said, you're going to love Phoenix. Phoenix is beautiful. I even though I'm a New Yorker, I've been blessed to travel a lot. And this part of the country, the southwest part of the country, the West Coast, I really believe is the most beautiful part of the country. I got to say that to y'all. It's just stunning when you come to this part of the country. And I just want to acknowledge the students again. Make some noise if you're a student at Phoenix College. Make some noise if you're a student at Phoenix College. All right. You know, let me say this to the students. No matter whether you are a teenager in your 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, I've met students as old as 80, 90 years old. I just say congratulations for being here and doing the work. Some people have said things like, well, I started late. No, you started right on time. You're here when you're supposed to be here at Phoenix College. Am I right, y'all? You know, and you're gonna get your education. I remind people that when we think about something like Black History Month, which was founded by Carter G. Woodson, Carter G. Woodson didn't get his high school diploma until he was in his 20s. He ended up getting a PhD and he became known as the father of Black history. So it's never too late to get your education. In fact, I would say education is lifelong no matter what. Would y'all agree with that? And so, oh yeah, I want to just say that to you all and know that even though we live in some very, very deep and dark times right now, I'm going to share some things with y'all. I have hope, even though this has been a hard year for me, hard. But what keeps me going are people like y'all in this audience. I told my wife the other day I did my first lecture for this school season in Pennsylvania on Sunday, and I'm so happy to be back on the road and just being able to interact with people. And I can't wait. What I'll probably do is speak as little as possible, then jump down there so we can actually have a conversation. Is that cool with y'all? That's why we got the two mics here, so I'm happy we have the mics. But I want to say a few things really quickly that's just on my heart and my soul. Number one, today's a serious day. Two deaths I think about. One is obviously your Senator John McCain, who just passed. Just missed his birthday. He's a Virgo like my mother, you know? And there's a lot to say. And I'll just say that, my mother has been ill the past couple of years. And when I heard about John McCain having brain cancer about a year ago, you know, it just kind of caused me pause for a second, because no matter what, you know, and I know people are liberals and conservatives and Democrats and Republicans, as the great philosopher John Donne once said, you know, we're all connected here. You know, when the bell tolls, for whom the bell tolls, it tolls for all of us, basically. I'm paraphrasing him. You know, John Donne also said that death diminishes us. And so when I heard that the senator last week decided to stop treatment, it meant that death was imminent, you know? And so I just, you know, want to pay my respects here. There's a lot of things I could say politically, but I just want to pay my respects, you know, because whether I agree with some politically or not, and there's a lot of things I do not agree with about some of the things that Mr. McCain has done through the years, including being one of the folks who did not support the Dr. King holiday as a national holiday, you know, the back and forth around immigration rights, things like that. I can't deny the fact that when someone passes, you need to just pay your respects. That's at least what my tradition as a Black person, where I come from, you honor the people who pass. So I just need to say that. I also want to acknowledge that today would have been the 60th birthday of Michael Jackson, the 60th birthday of Michael Jackson, which is profound, you know. He too had a complicated life, just like John McCain, full of greatness and genius, but also controversy and conflicts, and there's a lot of things we don't know what the truth is with Michael Jackson, unfortunately, you know. But I'll say this, you know, he touched generations of people. That's very clear. You know, there's not many musical artists who could say that they were multi-generational stars. You know, there's the Beatles, there's Michael Jackson, there's Prince, you know, probably Madonna, Nina Simone, you know, a few people, Bob Dylan, Bob Marley. There's not a lot, but Michael's definitely one of them. I want to talk about another great artist. I'm sure y'all never heard of her. Her name was Cardi B. Cardi B. Where I got part of the title for the program tonight. I like it. And those of us who know about something called Latin soul music from the 1960s and 1970s out of New York City, there was a great boogaloo band leader named Pedro Rodriguez, who had a song called I Like It Like That. And you know that Cardi B took samples of that song for her hit record, one of her hit records this summer. I can't speak for anyone else, but I'm deeply intrigued by this philosopher named Cardi B. And I say this because, and you know, people can laugh about it, but this is a woman of color, Afro-Latina woman, who comes from poverty, from a working class community, for economic reasons, you know, engaged in what we call the strip club industry. And she literally has propelled herself through her own hard work, whether you agree with it or not. You know, and one of the simple definitions of hip hop is making something out of nothing. And Cardi B has become one of the major stars in this country, which is pretty profound. She literally, hip hop literally is for many of us across generations, our own civil rights movement, our own way of being self-empowered. I want to ask people too, really quickly, do not videotape this because we are videotaping it officially back there and they're going to share it with folks. Is that right, Dean Thompson? So I'm asking y'all, please don't videotape it out of respect for the school. Is that all right, y'all? Okay. But that's where I got the title from. And, you know, I want to say to younger people here, when I say younger people, people under 30, under 40, you know, I hate it when people say things like, y'all are tomorrow's leaders. Y'all are future leaders. Y'all are leaders right now. Can y'all say right now? You know, and I think it's important, you know, a lot of people will focus on all the negative stuff about young people. I've heard stuff for years, how people wear their hair, how they dress, how they wear their pants, the tattoos, the piercings, et cetera. Every generation has its cultural thing. Are y'all with me out here? I may have on a suit now, but you better believe in the 1990s, my pants were sagging down to my ankles. I can tell you that for a fact. Because I'm a lifelong hip-hop head, you know, and we wear the clothes, the uniform of the culture. And so, you know, for young people out there, I just want to say to y'all, I believe in y'all. That's part of the reason why I'm here. But it's very important that y'all take seriously this educational opportunity that you have at Phoenix College. You're not only going to Phoenix College for yourself, but you're going to Phoenix College for all the people who will never have this opportunity. Are y'all with me out there? And so, oh yeah, and it's important that we take seriously excellence. Can y'all say excellent students? And so what I say to y'all, what that means is that, you know, you got an example in your dynamic young president when they listed his credentials. I said, this is a standard of what can be done. Every level of education, I heard bachelor's, I heard master's, I heard PhD. Are y'all with me? And so if he can be an example of excellence, then everyone in this room who's a student at Phoenix College can be an example of excellence. But it means that we gotta take studying seriously. I saw an article this morning when I got up saying that the average American now, instead of even reading things, books or articles or blogs or whatever it is, they say that what has become the phenomenon in our country is just skimming over stuff. Now, how are you gonna learn if you skim over stuff? Y'all with me? That doesn't make any sense. I mean, would Dr. Johnson have a PhD? Would Dean Thompson be a dean? Would Dr. Westenberg have a PhD if they just skimmed over stuff? Are y'all with me out there? And so when I think about I Like It, Young America Hip Hop and the Power of Voting and Being Woke, you can't be woke if you don't take studying seriously every day of your life. You know, we say I'm woke or someone is woke, but it's just become another phrase now. I'm like, no, woke to me means that you are committing yourself every single day of your life to learning something new. But it ain't just the young people I'm talking to. If you're over 40, if you're over 50, if you're over 60, if you're over 70, there's some of us in Generation X and the baby boomer generation who think we got it all figured out. No, some of the most ignorant, backwards folks I've ever met are in my generation and the generation above me. Or they're stuck in a time warp. They're stuck in the 90s, stuck in the 80s, stuck in the 70s. I love being around young people because I'm like, I'm born in the late 60s. I'm born in a different time. So if someone's born in the 80s, 90s, the 2000s, it means that there's some things I can learn from them just like there's some things they can learn from me. Are y'all with me out there? You know? And I'm saying to you all, one of the mistakes that I think a lot of older people do is they keep saying, well, young people, it's your time now, y'all gotta do it. It's like when the whole thing happened in Parkland, Florida. In Florida, sir, where you're, you know, you went to school, Dr. Johnson, with the young people out of Parkland, Florida. And I kept hearing all these folks saying, well, the young people, they gotta do it, they gotta do it, it's their time. No, what we need is a multicultural, multi-generational movement out there. And when I was a youth activist and a student leader, you know, they did the same thing to my generation. They put all this pressure on, well, young people, you gotta do it. No, we need to do it together. It's gotta be a collective effort. Are y'all with me? And so I say to older people, there's gonna be some things I'm gonna say tonight about hip hop. Dr. Westenberg asked me a question earlier. It was a legitimate question. You know, well, was I going to curse, or was there gonna be any cursing? Because someone was wondering, because the word hip hop was in the title of the speech. And I said, well, not every hip-hop head actually curses in public. You know what I mean? And we need to understand what hip-hop actually is, and I think that's part of the problem. And so if y'all don't mind, I'd like to break it down for a second, because how could you understand young people in these times, understand the role of a DJ, of an MC, of a dancer, graffiti writer, and we don't even know what hip-hop is? You know what I mean? Number one, how many of y'all celebrate Dr. King's holiday every year? Just by a show of hands. All right. What was the campaign that Dr. King was organizing at the end of his life? What was it called, y'all? What was it? Poor People's Campaign. 1967, April 4th, Dr. King gave a speech at Riverside Church in New York City called Beyond Vietnam. He became the first national leader of any note to come out against the Vietnam War. And people ask the question, well, why would you do that, Dr. King? You're a civil rights leader. Why would you talk about a global issue, an international issue? Well, Dr. King said, well, first of all, you know, silence is betrayal. Secondly, how can I be opposed to violence in America and then ignore the violence of my country against this place called Vietnam? Are y'all with me out there? He said in that speech, we're sending poor blacks and poor whites to go fight poor yellow people, Asian sisters and brothers, in a place called Vietnam. He was saying in that speech, money that could have been used to help poor people in this country, poor black, white, Latino, Asian, Native American brothers and sisters, all of us, is being used to drop bombs, just like Senator McCain participated in 23 bombing raids of Vietnam, dropping bombs on people. That money could have been used to educate people, to feed people. Are y'all with me out there? And so Dr. King said, wait a minute, there's something wrong with this, and you know, we need to go in a different direction. That was 1967. Well, something else happened in 1967. A young man named Clive Campbell, AKA Cool Herc, came from Jamaica in the West Indies to New York City. Specifically to the Bronx, New York, or what we call Uptown. Well, who was Clive Campbell? He was a DJ. What is the foundation of hip-hop? Just like the foundation of all music. We heard the African drummers when we were coming in, right? It's the beat, y'all. I don't care what music we're talking about. There's always the drum, the beat. Well, Clive Campbell, AKA Cool Herc, was a DJ. And some of the music that he was sampling was the popular music of the time. Well, who's one of the biggest artists of the day? His name was James Brown, right? And some of the music that James Brown made, well, really all of the music James Brown made, had these instrumental breaks, or what we call break beats, which means at some point they might be breaking or break dancers or B-boys and B-girls. Y'all feel where I'm going with this? You know what I mean? So hip-hop was actually created by the same poor people that Dr. King told us not to forget. Poor African Americans, poor West Indians, and poor Latinos, Latinx community, in New York City. And I need to say this to those of us who are black folks, stop acting like Latinos. Latinas were not a part of the creation of hip hop, because they were. Yeah, they were. And while that was happening in New York City, there was also a parallel energy happening on the West Coast in places like California, the Chicano, the Mexican community. If you go back and listen to Dr. Dre's The Chronic album and watch the videos of Dre and Snoop, the way they dressed, the lowriders, all of that came out of the Latino community, y'all. That wasn't the black community, but the black community was influenced by the Latino community, just like the Latino community was influenced by the black community, because it's called a cultural exchange. Are y'all with me out there? So that's the birth of hip hop. And what was it? Winning on your own terms, making something out of nothing, taking turntables, vinyl records, magic markers, spray paint to create visual art, or what we call graffiti. It's not vandalism. It's not vandalism. It's art, because if you take art out of the schools of poor communities, the kids are going to create art by any means necessary, including banging on a desk to make a beat. Am I all right, y'all? Including, you know what, let me start drawing in a notebook or drawing on my desk or drawing on walls, or if you're in New York City, drawing on subways, realizing that the whole subway train could be a moving canvas of art for you. And if you're the poor people that Dr. King told us not to forget, the way that you feel powerful is to create this culture where you can have these new names. Just like in jazz music, I may not be a Duke for real, but I'm gonna name myself Duke Ellington. I may not be a count for real, but I'm gonna become Count Basie. I may not be a doctor for real, but I'm gonna become Dr. Dre. Are y'all with me out there? Because people who feel disempowered on their own found ways to become powerful. Hip hop ain't no different than jazz, rock and roll, blues, spirituals, etc. It's all the music of a tradition. But if you think it's just what's on the radio, just stuff that you hear there, here and there, and you have no working knowledge of it, you are just speaking, or we're speaking, not just out of ignorance, but what I call enthusiastic ignorance. That's hip hop culture. That's what I represent. The culture. Now, the hip hop industry is something totally different. Are y'all with me? So there's the culture, which is what I represent, where I have enough sense to get on stage and not call myself an N or call women a B-I-T-C-H or a thought. I have enough sense not to start cursing up a storm, because I represent the culture, and the culture is supposed to be about life. But the industry oftentimes has been about death. Huh. The industry. When hip-hop started, and I was in the clubs in New York in the 1980s, it was 99.9% Latino people and black folks, and there might have been a few here and there Asian folks and white folks in New York City in the clubs. It was black and Latino people. That's who was there, right? But when MTV and BET started playing hip-hop, it came into places, and it started touching other people's lives. It started reaching, it became mass culture. And by the 1990s, hip hop, people say hip hop is now the most dominant culture music in the country. No, it's been like that for a long time, y'all, a very long time. How do I know? I was a founding staff member at Vibe magazine in the 1990s, and we were the fastest growing magazine in America in the 1990s. I wrote several cover stories on Dre, Snoop, Tupac, et cetera, and every single issue sold out rapidly. We were like, who are all these people reading this magazine? They were all over the country, touched by this thing called hip hop. I believe that some people, y'all can figure out for yourselves who they are, were scared of this culture that was created by these black and brown bodies, these black and brown people that was now reaching other people, including young white people, because like Chuck D of Public Enemy said, hip hop was our, or is our, CNN. It's the way we communicate with each other. Are y'all with me out there? And at a certain point in the late 80s, early 1990s, not only were we talking about the conditions in our communities, but you had rappers who were actually talking about serious social and political issues. You don't think so? Go back and listen to Lauryn Hill's Miseducation of Lauryn Hill 20 years ago this year. She's talking about racism. She's talking about sexism. She's talking about mental health. There's a range of stuff on that album. Y'all with me out there? I believe that some folks said, we're gonna kill certain aspects of the culture, and we're gonna turn it into an industry, and we're gonna mass produce that and make people think that all you can be is an N-I-G-G-A and a B-I-T-C-H, and all we're gonna focus on is drugs and alcohol and violence and madness and mayhem and anti-intellectualism. You're not gonna be a critical thinker, and you're gonna make the same songs and same videos over and over and over again, just like the minstrel shows that which were created by racist white people in the 1830s and 1840s in this country, where black folks were depicted as over-sexualized, immoral, violent, dangerous, and that became the dominant industry in this country for 100 years. You don't think so? I guarantee you someone in this room still eats Aunt Jemima's pancakes and Uncle Ben's rice, not realizing where these racist stereotypes came from. Y'all with me out there? But what I'm getting at is that racism is an industry. And hip hop culture got turned into an industry over here where, as we were trying to promote this program, Dr. Westenberg asked me to do some radio interviews. I did a couple of them. But one of your hip hop stations here today in Phoenix, you know, said, one of the program directors, I'm not gonna say which one, you can use your imagination, was asking the question, wouldn't even talk to me directly, but said, well, what does Kevin Powell want to talk about? And you know, I'm not someone who's gonna sit here and run down my resume, but since you asked, I was a graffiti writer, I was a b-boy. As I said, I was a founding staff member of Quincy Jones's Vibe magazine. My 14th book will be a biography of Tupac Shakur. I curated or produced the very first exhibit on the history of hip-hop in this country with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and then we brought it to the Brooklyn Museum in New York, where 500,000 people came to the hip-hop exhibit. I lecture about hip-hop all around the country and globally. When Barack Obama was the president of the United States, I was sent overseas by the State Department to Japan to talk about Dr. King and also things like hip-hop. Are y'all with me out there? And so I'm saying to myself, well, I think I'm qualified to be on your radio station in Phoenix. I think I know a little something about this thing called hip-hop. But what I realized by the questions that were coming about, well, what does he want to talk about? What they were afraid of is that, wait a minute, Kevin Powell doesn't represent the industry where he's just gonna say ignorant, foolish stuff. He actually represents the culture where he is going to say some things about the state of this country. And therefore, we can't have him on the radio. Not here. Because this is a red state, and you got people in this red state who are scared of the truth. But you know what doesn't really matter if it's a red state, because I live in New York, which is a blue state, and we got people scared of the truth in New York. The problem is that we live in a country where a lot of people are scared. And the culture that I come from, hip hop, is about being fearless. It's about being honest. It's about being truth tellers. Are y'all with me out there? We have enough cowards in this country. We have enough cowards in this country who don't want to say what it is. Well, I'll say what it is. Donald Trump is a racist, sexist, homophobic, transphobic, anti-immigrant, privileged bigot. I'll say what it is. Except for Native American people, indigenous people, the First Nation people whose land was stolen. Well, they believe the land belonged to everybody, but who were the victims of genocide. And my ancestors, African people who were stolen from Africa and built the economic infrastructure of this country, black people, for free for nearly 300 years. Everyone else, I mean, my gosh, my wife's and I talked about it today. When we got to Arizona, she said, Arizona sure looks like Mexico. I said, well, Arizona and Nevada and Colorado and California and New Mexico certainly are Mexico, because this land was stolen from Mexican people. I mean, let's be real about this. This doesn't mean that you don't love your country. If you really love your country, if you really love this planet, then you tell the truth about what has happened to people. Because you don't get to democracy or justice or equality if, like Dr. King and Fannie Hamer and Ella Baker and Malcolm X and Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huertas and all the folks who came before us who sacrificed their lives, they were willing to tell the truth. Are y'all with me out there? I have people who say to me that they're Christians, but they're scared of telling the truth. Well, Jesus was about telling the truth, which is why he was crucified. Are y'all with me out there? You know what I mean? And the truth is, we are not the country we used to be. We wouldn't be sitting here with this beautiful diversity. We wouldn't be sitting here the way we are if it wasn't for people who sacrificed and pushed the women's rights movement, the Native American movement, the gay rights movement, the civil rights movement. We can go on and on and on. The labor movement. Are y'all with me out there? There was sacrifice and struggle. You know, democracy just doesn't happen. When you see hashtag MeToo happening right now with women of all backgrounds, what women are saying, my wife has a show called She, a choreo play, which is about ending violence against women and girls. Women are saying, we've had enough of patriarchy, sexism, misogyny. Men, especially us who are heterosexual men, you need to check yourselves and your power and your privilege. That means me and every man sitting here. Now, if a radio station programmer is afraid of all of that, and they're supposed to be representing a culture created by black and brown poor people that Dr. King told us not to forget, that says to me that that person has no interest in your community other than a paycheck. That's what it says to me. All this is a paycheck in this market, and maybe hoping they can get to the next market with another radio programming gig. Are you with me out there? This is where we are. This is where we are. And so when I think about America, I don't care if you're blue or red. I don't care if you call yourself a liberal or a conservative. I don't care if you're a Democrat or Republican at this point. I mean, come on. What I care about is what kind of human being you're trying to be. Do you care about other human beings? You know? Do you actually know who you are? You know what I'm saying? And do you have the courage to learn about people who might be different than you? Some of y'all may have heard me speak Spanish a little bit when we started. I wouldn't know Spanish if it wasn't for my Mexican and Colombian and Dominican and Puerto Rican and the entire Latina, Latinx diaspora, because I made it a point since I was a child. I don't know why I did it, but I fell in love with Latino culture, Latina culture, with the language. And when I became an adult and I started discovering writers of color, first black writers, then Latino writers, I was like, man, this is a beautiful culture. I want to learn about this culture. I'm not scared of this culture. Are y'all with me? You know what I mean? For God's sakes, I'm writing a book about Tupac Shakur. Tupac Amaru Shakur, his mother got his name from a Latin American country called Peru in South America, y'all. Y'all see what I'm saying? But if you see yourself only as a liberal or a conservative, a Democrat or Republican, red or blue state, then you too will fall into the traps of things like racism. Racism. Well, what is racism? Some people will define it where everyone is just, we all can equally be racist. No, racism is race plus power and privilege. In any given society, who has it and who does not have it? And in this society where we live called America, I, as a black man, as a black person, as a person of color, I certainly could be prejudiced. I'm not. I love all people. We're all equals as far as I'm concerned. I love all people. But racism means that you have the ability to control neighborhoods, resources that go to that neighborhood. You have the ability to control schools and what kind of books go into those schools, state of Arizona. Racism means that you have the ability to dictate what kind of information gets put out there in the news. It means that if football players who happen to be black are protesting injustice, racism means you have the ability to twist it from them protesting racial profiling, police brutality, and turning into they're unpatriotic and they don't support the troops. That's racism. When many of those football players, just like me, have family members who have served in the military for generations. Because few people are as patriotic and as loyal as we are as black people in this country. I'm just saying. We stand up first for the national anthem. We know the words better than anybody else. We certainly know it better than Donald Trump because he don't know the words. Am I wrong? Racism also means, you know, something like John McCain can not only oppose the holiday of Dr. King, but he can call Vietnamese people years later gooks still, quote unquote. He can go back and forth around immigration issues. He can be someone who called for the building of a wall before Donald Trump did to keep Latinos, Latinas out of Arizona and other states. Y'all know what I'm talking about. This is all documented. You can Google this stuff. That's racism. You know? Racism means I can go to school in any state in this country, unless it's a different kind of school district, K through 12, and not learn anything about people who are Native American, African American, Latino, Latina, Latinx, Asian, Muslim, Arab, any people of color, and no one ever questions any of it. That's called racism, y'all. I'm being taught in 2018 that Christopher Columbus discovered America when we know that Christopher Columbus was actually a terrorist who terrorized indigenous people. If you don't think so, read a book called A People's History of the United States by Howard Zinn, a Jewish brother who had the courage to tell the truth about the history of this country. Are y'all with me out there? That's called racism. Racism means when Latino people or Asian people come to this country, instead of saying, how can I learn your language? Because most Americans don't even speak a second language. We're telling people who are Latino, Latina, or Asian, y'all need to learn English. That's called racism, y'all. No, how about humanism where I meet you halfway? I help you learn English and you help me learn your language. How about that, y'all? Y'all with me out there? Because that's real education, it's interactive. You teach me and I teach you. But when it's an oppressive pedagogy, it's my way or no way. That's not an education. Are y'all with me? That's racism. Racism is the reason why hip-hop culture was created in the first place, because someone thought that those African-American, Latino, and West Indian people, poor people, had no value, so they just discarded them. And little did they realize that here they were creating in the ghetto, the ghettos of California and the ghettos of New York, this culture that would be the dominant culture on the planet for the last 40 years called hip-hop. Racism. Racism is when I was at a school in Pennsylvania on Sunday, and one of the students got up and said that he was anti-immigrants, white brother. And I said, well, where are your people from? And he said, well, Ireland and Poland and Italy and Germany. And I said, here's how racism operates. Because white sisters and brothers, y'all act like y'all were here all along. And I'm saying to y'all, with all due respect, because I love all people, don't get it twisted, I love all people. But we got to tell the truth here, which is everyone came from somewhere else. And if you just read basic history, like Frank McCourt's book, Angela's Ashes, the great, late great Irish American writer, there was a time when Irish people were treated like garbage. There was a time when Italian people were treated like garbage. There was a time when Jewish people were treated like garbage. Can we go down the list, y'all? Watch a movie called Gangs of New York, Martin Scorsese's film, where you see native whites fighting against ethnic whites. Y'all know what I'm talking about. But at some point, people assimilate into society, and they go from being Irish and Italian to what one white student said to me at the school. Another white student said, I said, well, what are you? He said, I'm just white. If you believe that you're just white, then it also means that it's okay to be just racist. And we don't want you to be just white. We want you to be just human and know who you are and how you got here and how a system called white supremacy and racism and or racism basically swallows people up and perpetuates this notion that one group is superior and everybody else is inferior. That's racism. I'll just say this as an African American. Immigration is the major civil rights issue of our times. The rights of immigrants. How could we sit here and watch families be split apart? How many of y'all call yourselves Americans by a show of hands? In some form or fashion, Americans. Just, okay. That means that we have a working knowledge of American history. Am I right, y'all? Okay. So when I think about families being split apart, I think about my ancestors on plantations, African people being split apart. Parents separated from each other, children separated from each other. Does that sound familiar, y'all? When I think about families being split apart, I think about, my gosh, if I was Japanese American during World War II. Japanese American during World War II put in internment camps and separated families. Y'all with me? And what I'm saying to y'all, this is not new. We cannot talk about voting and being woke. I mean, it'd be ridiculous for me to stand here and just say, y'all just need to vote, with the assumption that people here actually know basic American history. Many of us do not. And I'm not being arrogant about it or disrespectful about it, but I'm just saying with all due love and respect, I have been to all 50 states in this country at this point, every major city, medium-sized city, small towns, rural areas, and it's breathtaking how little Americans know about America. I go to Japan, as I said a couple years ago, the Japanese knew more about America than we did. I was in Wales. The Welsh knew more about America than we did. I'm in England. They know more about America than we do. I'm in Africa. They know more about America than we do. I'm in Latin America. They know more about America than we do. There's something wrong with that. And so that's why, you know, even my own mother, who was born in segregated America in 1943, and saw a world that was blacks and whites only, when she moved from the South to the North, she also became inculcated, brainwashed with this notion of the others. Y'all with me? My mother would say disrespectful stuff about Latino people, about Asian people, about whites who weren't Anglo-Saxon Protestant white folks. Y'all feel me? And what I'm saying to y'all, we can't even talk about voting and being woke if we don't understand that these divisions are destroying us. It doesn't matter if it's Donald Trump or Barack Obama in the White House. What we need to understand, going back to 1964, when a United States Senator named Barry Goldwater from Arizona ran for President of the United States, and people said that he was an extremist because he was preaching hate, he was actually laying the foundation with his very words for the Republican Revolution, the conservative movement that has dominated this country for the last 40 years. Again, I don't care if you're a liberal conservative, I don't care if you're a Democrat Republican. What I care about is if you care about people or you only care about a few in this country. Are y'all with me out there? It was hardened in 1968 when Nixon became president of the United States. There was a brilliant white brother, Irish-American brother, who's one of my heroes, named Bobby Kennedy, who was running for president of the United States in 68, and 2 months after Dr. King was killed, he was killed. Bobby had the unique ability to bring all different types of people together. Someone didn't want that because, God, why would we want to have people come together? Shouldn't we be together? Do y'all believe in love? I believe in love. I love all people. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with love? You know, people come up to me and say, Kevin Powell, I don't like your politics. I'm like, my politics are love and peace and nonviolence. What's wrong with that? That's Jesus's politics. That's Gandhi's politics. That's Dr. King's politics. That means everybody together. Bobby Kennedy is killed. Nixon becomes president. Within 12 years, Ronald Reagan becomes president of the United States. This divisiveness goes from being the extreme of Barry Goldwater from Arizona 64 to the norm in this country to this day. This is why we have racism, anti-immigrant sentiments. This is why the hashtag MeToo movement has exploded. This is why we have all kinds of hate crimes against people of color, against people who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, because there's hatred everywhere. And I'm not saying you got to believe in my politics, but I'm saying to y'all out there, if you hate somebody because of who they are, you're a toxic human being. You're just a toxic human being. And you're participating in the oppression. We know that a Jewish brother named Brother Cohen has a show called, what is it called, y'all? What is America? Who is America? And he ended up in Kingman, Arizona. Did y'all see that episode? Who knows what I'm talking about? Sacha Baron Cohen. And in Kingman, Arizona, the folks showed who they really were. They said, they were baited into it. No, here's how character operates. The way character operates, you are who you are, whether there's cameras around or not. You are who you are, whether you're baited into something or not. So if you're a racist, if you're a bigot, if you're a sexist, if you're a homophobe, if you're a transphobe, if you're anti-immigrant, that's who you are. And so he caught them on camera saying stuff that was Islamophobic and other things. And then the city got embarrassed. At first, they were trying to cover it up. Then they said, well, you know what? We realized we got some work to do. Well, yeah, you got some work to do. Because you clearly don't want people who are not you in your city. When we talk about where we are and being woke, we got 325 million people in this country, sisters and brothers, fellow human beings, and we got over 300 million guns in this country. Now, I'm gonna say this to y'all. I grew up in an environment, family, household, community that was violent. So guess what? I was violent. And it was normal to be violent. And some of y'all who are in my generation know what I'm talking about. Fellas who are heterosexual, and if you were hyper-masculine like I was, you would hear conversations like, yo, meet me after school, son. You know what I mean? Meet me after school, son. And this rites of passage where the boys would fight each other. And what I noticed over time, we went from fighting with our hands. I remember when the first time I saw someone pick up a bat and clubbed another man, young man over the head with a bat, and then it went to someone got stabbed to death with a knife, and all of a sudden we all got guns and people are shooting and murdering each other. And that ain't enough. Then it becomes mass shootings that have multiplied excessively just in the last 20 years in this country. I can't speak for anyone else, but I think that violence is a sickness. It's a sickness. And I'm not just talking about physical violence. I'm not just talking about physical violence, but I'm talking about verbal violence. I mean, my wife will tell you, we just drove my mother down south. I love my mother, but my mother is verbally violent, verbally abusive. And when you have been the victim, as I was, of verbal abuse, guess what you become when you grow up? Either you become verbally abusive or you just take abuse all the time from other people. Now, some of you are smiling about this, but I think there's something actually insane about any society where violence is so normal, where people can just curse each other out, yell at each other, disrespect each other all over social media. We brace ourselves. Every 2 weeks or so, there's a mass shooting in the country. Have y'all noticed that? Rape happens every day to women in this country. Domestic violence happens every couple of seconds to women in this country. Colin Kaepernick can't play football anymore for a civil, peaceful protest, but you got men playing in the National Football League who have beaten up women over and over again, including on the Phoenix Cardinals. So how are we going to talk about voting and being woke if we're also not going to have serious conversations about where we are? The point I'm getting at is that if we're serious about being leaders, how many of y'all are serious about being leaders out there? You consider yourself a leader. Right? You wouldn't just have one tool in your toolbox, would you, if you were a plumber or if you were a carpenter, would you? You have to have multiple tools in that toolbox. So one of the tools is voting. Voting is very important, you know? And the way I was raised by my mother, who grew up in the South, when you turn 18, you have to vote. You have to vote. You have to vote. And I will say to you all out there who do not vote, that's my mother talking to me. I take that very seriously. I'm actually frustrated when I miss an election. But that's for me. Why do I do it that way? Because my mother instilled that in me, a value system around voting. And number two, when I got to college and I started learning the history of the Civil Rights Movement, which was never taught to me when I was growing up, in spite of being an A student and going to magnet schools, I realized there was a whole history of people sacrificing just so I could have the right to vote. So even on a simple level, just out of respect for them, people who literally got killed, I said, man, let me go and vote. Are y'all with me out there? And because I became an activist when I was in college as well, I began to realize that all movements are local. And I live, and I've lived in Brooklyn, New York for the last 30 years almost, right? And I realized if I don't vote in Phoenix or Brooklyn or wherever I live, guess what, y'all? That means that anyone can be a judge, justice of the peace, city council, or alderperson, the mayor, governor. It means that I don't have any say in that. It means that all those black and brown bodies that are filling up prisons in this country, including in the state of Arizona, I'm not having any say on even how the prison industrial complex is destroying my community. Are y'all with me out there? It means I'm having no say over the resources that come or do not come to my communities, including my schools. Are y'all with me out there when I do not vote? You have a right not to vote. You can say, man, voting don't change anything. Well, I'm going to say to y'all, my wife and I live in downtown Brooklyn. I see the parade of poor people, particularly black and Latinx people, going to court every single day, Monday through Friday. And most of them are going in front of people who do not care about their lives, who were voted in by the handful of people who actually show up at the polls on a regular basis. And those young people are being given ridiculous plea deals and being sent away, and their lives are destroyed. Now, that's not the only reason for the prison industrial complex. It's a whole other conversation. But voting is important. Voting is important in the sense that Your president, Dr. Johnson, just said it. His classmate and my old friend, Andrew Gillum, a black man who I met when he was young, in his 20s. This brother was on a mission, am I right, sir? He was determined, I'm gonna be a leader. And here he is now, the first major candidate who is black to be nominated to be governor of the state of Florida. Why is that important? Because for me, as someone who has organized in the state of Florida, this is where voting matters. Because a lot of folks don't show up and vote on a regular basis. Laws like Stand Your Ground get to pass, which is the law that protected people like George Zimmerman after he killed Trayvon Martin. When I don't participate in voting in the state of Florida, guess what? Some foul stuff can go down with voting in districts in the state of Florida, which is why you had that deadlock in the state of Florida in 2000 between George W. Bush and Al Gore. And we know that Al Gore really won that election, but there was some shady stuff going on with the Secretary of State in the state of Florida. This is why we gotta read, y'all, and know what's going on. Are y'all with me out there? This is why voting matters. And when we don't vote, guess what? People like myself, and I feel a few other folks who actually care, we're the ones that are constantly dealing with the issue of voting rights. When voting rights was passed back after the Civil War, when voting rights was passed again in 1965 during the middle of the Civil Rights Movement, it was not or has never been permanent. It's something that we constantly have to check because people are constantly being knocked off the rolls, y'all. So this is why voting is important. But it can't just be the only tool in our toolbox. We also have to take leadership seriously. I don't know how else to say this other than hashtag, can y'all say it? Hashtag, read, study, travel. How you gonna be a leader if you don't hashtag read, study, and travel for the rest of your lives? What kind of leader are you if you don't read, you don't study, and you don't go nowhere? I meet people, I'm gonna give you an example. I showed up in Ferguson when Michael Brown got killed. There was a whole bunch of stuff going on, protests, right? On the street where he was killed. It was a real narrow street. There was a group of young black men who were playing the loudest, most insane hip hop that was inappropriate for what was going on with Michael Brown. It was like a bad version of NWA, you know what I'm saying? Just cursing up a storm, but it wasn't even good. It was just whack. So, you know, you got folks from the NAACP there, God bless the NAACP, you got church folks there. So I said, man, let me go across the street and talk to these brothers and be like, yo. And I went to the leader, he had on his shades, he was loped out, right? And I said, man, sir, we're trying to protest the murder of Michael Brown and you're playing music that's referring to our people as N-I-G-G-A's. Man, you don't understand, brother. You know what I'm saying? I was like, well, tell me what I don't understand. He said, well, you know, man, you know, we reclaiming the word. And I said, well, have you ever heard of a book called The N-Word by Jabari Asim, which is about the history of the N-Word and where it came from? Nah, man. I said, have you ever heard of The Last Poets, who are the foundation for what became known as hip-hop? Are you? Nah, man. Well, I said, well, have you ever read Langston Hughes or Sonia Sanchez? You know, great poets who always talked about our community. Nah, man. And guess what, y'all? He was from Chicago, and he was a school teacher. So here's someone who was teaching kids, because teachers, to me, are the real leaders in our communities oftentimes. And here's someone who was teaching kids, and he didn't even have a basic understanding of history. Are y'all with me out there? And so I'm saying to y'all, how are we gonna be woke if we don't hashtag read, study, travel? One reason why, there's many reasons why I love my wife, but one of the main reasons is that we are constantly reading, constantly sharing information with each other. I wouldn't wanna be with anyone who's not intellectually curious. You know what I'm saying? Are y'all with me? But some reason in the 21st century, it's become corny to be an intellectual. You know what I mean? When I heard the president's, Dr. Johnson's resume, one last time I'm gonna say this, that's as important to me as listening to a hip hop album. Because it represents the diversity of the possibilities of what a black man can be when we've been stereotyped to be only one thing, a thug, or an athlete, or a rapper. Y'all with me? So we can't talk about voting and being woke if we don't hashtag read, study, travel. Women in this country, y'all know this, it's still been less than 100 years since women got the right to vote. If you're 18 years old, it's been less than 50 years since an 18-year-old has had the right to vote. Y'all with me? We gotta know this history. This is important because this is how the small minority that has gotten away with all kinds of shenanigans, including putting someone who's a buffoon in the White House named Donald Trump, because most folks are ignorant of their basic rights and don't know basic history. There's something wrong when you look at the last election in 2016. I mean, come on, y'all. There's 325 million people in this country. Only 100,000 or so voted. What happened to the rest of the people who are eligible to vote? Where are they at? And I am not saying voting is the answer for everything. I would never, never, never say that. You got to organize. You got to protest. You got to build and create organizations and institutions and businesses and create art that serves the people, that reflects the people. We got to do a multitude of things. But you at least, if you're going to live in America, you should at least know the system that you're living under, how it operates. So here's where we are. What do we need to do? How to be woke? I'm saying to you all, we need to question what leadership is. A real simple definition, I'm going to close it here. In my opinion, this is just my opinion. You can come up with your own definitions. A leader, number one, she, he, or they creates a new language if you're really a leader. You don't keep saying the same stuff over and over again. You don't repeat what other people say. You create your own vocabulary. Y'all with me? One thing I love about millennials, where are the millennials out there? People who are under 30, who are in their early 30s out there and getting younger. One of the things I love about millennials, y'all gave us the term woke. We were not saying woke before millennials started saying woke. And I'm like, yo, that's dope, son. I love that, woke. Because we would say, in my generation, yo, they mad conscious. Yo, we would say you conscious. Millennials, that's leadership. I'm going to create a new word to describe that I am aware of what's going on in the world. That's what leaders do. They create a new language. If you're a leader, you challenge all forms of oppression, not just what's convenient for you. Are y'all with me out there? If you're a leader, you challenge all forms of oppression. How are you going to be a leader if you're racist or sexist or classist or anti-Semitic or Islamophobic or homophobic or transphobic or hate poor people or hate disabled people or hate disabled people or hate disabled people? Are y'all with me out there? How are you going to be a leader and you're saying that you're opposed to one form of oppression that's convenient for you, but then you're oppressive toward other people? Are y'all with me out there? Yeah? How are you going to be woke? You can't be half woke. You need to be all the way woke. That's what leadership is. If you're going to be a leader, you got to be honest and transparent. I'm saying to y'all, we got a lot of folks out there who are liars, who are liars, who are liars. People who pretend to be leaders. People who are one way in public and another way privately all the time. Maybe to my detriment, I mean, I got a lot of issues, and boy, did a lot of them come out this year. But you know what? People know exactly who I am. Like, I'm hurting right now. I sure could use some therapy. I can use some exercise. I can use some yoga. I'm not gonna pretend that I'm something that I'm not. Y'all with me? If you're a leader, you're honest, you're transparent. If you're really woke, you're honest, you're transparent. If you're really trying to be woke, you're always growing, you're always trying to change. How do you grow? How do you change? You got a hashtag, read, study, travel. It's back to that. There's no getting around that. There's no getting around that. If you're really a leader, you got to be up on current events, history, pop culture, sports, technology. You got to know what's going on. You know, I don't see how we can be leaders, and I meet people who say, well, man, I'm not on Facebook, that's beneath me, or I'm not on Instagram, that's beneath me. And my response is, well, most of the people in America and on the planet are on social media. If you're really a leader, you need to be where the people are. It's pretty basic. Because sometimes, I'm a grassroots organizer, so I learned how to organize in the community, but at some point I realized, you know what, you better be on LinkedIn and Twitter and Facebook and Instagram, because there's a whole community out there that you need to be connected to. Y'all with me? If you're a leader, if you're really trying to be woke. If you're trying to be woke, it also means that we gotta be selfless, y'all. We gotta be selfless, y'all. One of the things that me and my wife have run into this year a lot are a lot of selfish people. A lot of selfish people. It's me, 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 me. What are you gonna do for me? What about me? What about me? What about me? What about us? What about what Dr. King said? We need to practice a dangerous kind of selflessness, y'all. You know what I'm saying? If you're gonna be a leader, if you're gonna be woke, it means you gotta be selfless. You know, I don't know about y'all. I mean, I don't want to die poor like Dr. King did, like Malcolm X did. But what I am saying is that I live a simple life. I don't have a lot of things materially. I don't want a lot of things materially because I'm like, you know what? My life is of service. I want to help people. I really am woke here. I take this seriously as an artist, as a writer, as an activist. You know, I take all of this stuff seriously. And that means that, you know what? I believe in helping people. So if someone comes to me, when I say selfless, I also mean being accessible to people. I don't know about here, but some of the schools I go to, people don't respond to people's emails. They don't respond to people's phone calls. Or they say things, you know what we say in America a lot? I'm just so busy. You too busy to be human? You too busy to get back to people? Or you got to go through their secretaries or their secretary's secretary's secretary. You know what I mean? And so I'm saying, when we talk about where we are as young people and older people and where we are in America, I'm saying we gotta get back to being selfless and supporting each other and loving each other. And it's not just that, but it's gotta be minimal ego. And understanding at the end of the day, if you really call yourself woke, if you really call yourself a leader, leaders create other leaders. Leaders create other leaders. Leaders create other leaders. And leaders never call themselves all the time leaders. You just do the work. You just do the work. So in closing, I like it. Young people and the power of voting and being woke is really for all of us. You know, we are in some very deep times in this country. But I really believe we've been in deep times in this country every year. This is not new. I think the challenges seem a little different to people, and some folks are just getting woke, and so they're like in shock about some stuff. But I mean, if you are any group that's been marginalized, women or black folks or Latino folk or Asian folks or queer folks or poor folks or disabled folks, this is not new. We felt this in some form or fashion. Am I right, y'all? You know? And so what I say at the end of it all, and the thing that I grapple with the most now, and I share this with my wife all the time, you know, my personal disappointment with how disrespectful a lot of us are to each other, you know, how hurtful a lot of us are to each other, the lack of love out there. And I'm just saying to y'all, we've got to find some love. We've got to find some love. We've got to find some love. And if you don't know how to love yourself, we need to figure out how to love ourselves, because you can't love anyone else if you don't love yourself. If you're at least not making an effort to love yourself, but we got to make an effort to love ourselves and to love each other. You know, I think about that now. Even when I have disagreements with people, I don't want to hurt people. I don't want to intentionally be malicious toward people. You know, if I make mistakes, I try to own up to it. You know, I'm stubborn. I'm a Taurus. I will admit it. I'm a Taurus. It's hard to hear the truth sometimes. But at the end of the day, I think about everything, because that's what being woke to me really means, that I think, or we think about everything that we do, and not only how it affects us, but how it affects other people in the human family. Thank y'all, and God bless y'all. So, y'all, please don't stand up unless you're getting going to do a question. Can we do questions? Just come up to the microphone. Questions, comments. Hey.
Hello.
Say your name, please.
Yes, my name is Rowdy Duncan. I teach communication here. One of the things and I'm blessed to have some of my communication students here. I teach public speaking.
Oh, great.
One of the things I talk about a lot is silence and compliance. They don't rhyme, but it's pretty close. And the importance of finding your own voice. If you could tell the students, why is it so important that they find their voice and find a way to speak up and talk about their unique experience, especially if they come from a marginalized community where they've heard over and over again, don't talk.
Yeah, that was me. For the students, you know, I was told shut up and be quiet most of my childhood. And as a result, I was an introvert. When I did speak, I would speak very, very fast all the time. I would talk with my hand over my mouth a lot. And I didn't think my voice mattered. It wasn't until I got to college and I started to get involved in student organizations and had professors like you who are real mentors and selfless like you are, that I realized that my voice didn't matter. And I say that to all of you out here who are students, your voice matters, your voice matters, your voice matters. It does matter. That's, you know, y'all are powerful. You got to understand that. We live in a world where people want you to be silent. They want you to not say anything. I was in a conversation this morning with some folks in California for a community event we're doing, and the community leader, one of the community leaders actually said to me that they don't want to do a lot of speaking. They don't want to be out there too much. I'm like, you know what? You are silencing yourself. You know, and I actually believe at some point silence can also become a form of fear. You know, and I had to get over that. I was like, I'm not afraid of anything, man. My voice is important. If I got something to say, I'm going to say it. You know, and that's just the way it is. I think that it doesn't take millions of people to change the society. It takes a few committed voices, a few committed energies, and that's always been the case. But someone's got to do it, you know?
All right. I'm going to try my best to articulate this question correctly. My name is Aaron Michael. I'm a student here.
Yes, sir.
And I want to know, like, what you have to say to someone who feels like, as far as what's going on with police brutality in America right now, which seems like to be a lot on African-American males like myself, like, what would you say to the people who kind of have a outlook to where it's like the only way we can really have justice is if we react with violence as well? Because like you said, you know, you grew up in an area where you're used to violence, and I did too, and it seems like, you know, we have been taking the high road for a long time,
yeah,
and it don't really seem like anything is changing. And so someone who, like myself, sometimes feels like the only way to match that or to really be heard is to match it with violence.
Well, let me put it to you like this, sir. As an activist, you can imagine the conversations I've had over the past 30 years. One of the first things I learned is that if you really want to do something, you never say it in public. That's number one.
True.
You know what I'm saying? Number two, I've evolved toward to nonviolence. That's what I believe in. The only thing I can say is that in that book down there, there's a chapter called High School, where I talk about when I was 15 years old, me and a Puerto Rican brother had a fight on the school bus, and we both were pulled off the bus. The Puerto Rican brother was a quote-unquote white Puerto Rican. I'm a black male. He was taken off the bus gingerly. I was thrown off the bus. There was two white officers. He was put in the front seat. He was not handcuffed at all. You know what I'm saying? I was handcuffed with my hands behind my back, sitting next to a white police officer. I'll never forget him. His name was Officer Quinn. He was like 6'3", 6'4", 200 pounds, red hair, red mustache, glasses. He said some things to me I didn't like. I was 15 years old. I may have weighed 100 pounds. I was a puny little 15-year-old boy. I'm from the hood. I said some things back to him. You know what he did? He balled his fist up, and he smashed me in my face and bloodied my whole face. That was my introduction to the police as a young man. And it became the reason why, from that day forward, I don't hate the police, but, you know, I would like to have as little interaction as possible with police officers anywhere in this country.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I'm saying? And it's the reason why I have protested my entire adult life, racial profiling, police brutality, all over the country, including in New York City, where it happens all the time. When I was a Muslim in a Nation of Islam, they taught us some basic things about how to conduct ourselves if we're stopped by the police. I feel like part of the challenge for us, we can't control what they do, but what we can control is, like, let me just make sure, you know, there's nothing in this car, there's nothing on me, you know, my hands are being shown. It sucks that we have to live like that, and this is the racism I was talking about, because who else has to think about this but people of color? And particularly for some reason, black.
That there are people who don't have anything with their hands. Their hands are shown.
I know.
They're still being killed.
So I know. Like, I know. Because the racism is completely out of control. Now, you and I can have a private conversation about some things, you know, but I'm not going to sit here on camera and talk about this. You feel what I'm saying, sir?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I just wanted to know your take on it. That's all.
You know, but I'm saying that what I do think is, on camera, what I can say is we got to make sure we do everything we can to stay alive.
Okay.
You know, one of my cousins got pulled over by the police, 6-7 months ago. He was drinking and driving. He's in his 40s. And did the police treat him right? No, they took his car. He's going back and forth to court the whole 9 yards. It's messed up how they're treating him. But one of the conversations me and his wife had is, like, you know what? You can't even give folks the rope to hang you with. You can't even give them an inch. You know what I'm saying? Because they will take that, you know? And I just think that it sucks that we have to think like that. I mean, we just drove down south. Like I said, me and my wife, I mean, we're thinking about, and it's not just, we got to stop saying it's just black men. Black women are being brutalized by the police all over this country as well. In her show, She, a choreo play, there's a section about Sandra Bland, who was brutalized by the police. And in that show, there's other video of black women throughout who've been brutalized by the police. It's just black bodies. It's Latino-Latina bodies that are a threat to the racists in this country. And it's not just white officers, it's black and Latino and Asian officers as well who have been brainwashed with white supremacy. So they think, like these white officers, that these black and Latino bodies are valueless and they can do anything they want to it. You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, my response on a simple level, you live here in Phoenix?
Yes.
Are y'all organizing? Where's your groups at? You know what I'm saying? And I'm talking about just being aware of all this stuff. You want to talk, people think the Black Panther Party was all about guns and fighting back against police. Actually, two of the most brilliant things that the Black Panther Party did was Huey Newton and Bobby Seale actually studied the law. Back to hashtag read, study, travel. They learned the laws. And that's how they were able to challenge the racism of the Oakland Police Department. You know what I mean? And so when people get up and say, well, I want to fight back, I'm like, well, do you know how you want to fight back? Do you know what I'm saying? You know, like what is, because it's about organizing. It's always about organizing. Whatever you want to do, are you organized? And where are the group of like-minded people who are also woke in a certain kind of way? The Black Panthers, they had to study. This was not a game for them. You know what I mean? As I'm working on this book on Tupac Shakur, don't forget Fannie Shakur, his mother was a Black Panther. They had to read. They had to study. You know what I mean? Because otherwise, we're just reacting. Yeah. I want to be proactive. I don't want to be reactionary. Does that make sense?
Yeah, definitely.
So whatever you decide to do, you want to be proactive, not reactionary. What are we proactively going to do here to resist and push back against racial profiling, police brutality? Now, you have to decide that for yourself, you know? And that's what I say. And the rest of it, we can talk off camera.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
Peace.
Okay. My name's Kumo, and I'm a student here. My question is, living in a state like Arizona, where sometimes black people or, you know, it feels like you can be by yourself in the fight. Let's say if it's quote unquote organizations that claim to be about serving the diverse population.
Yes,
but
ma'am.
Then you have black people on that staff that are more oppressed, like have become kind of like accommodating the white man in a sense. So like they're more in the sunken place. So how do you
get out, like the movie? Yeah. We're gonna quote that movie forever, ever.
So they're more like in the sunken place, and it's more of like a fight with them as well, because they don't understand. It's kind of like they don't. I feel like my question is not being articulate.
All the questions are articulate and excellent, of y'all.
Okay, so I just feel like here in Arizona, being in Arizona, sometimes it can be a fight with black people when it comes to like being in the nonprofit sector, simply because it's like they're not, it's more kind of like you're accommodating the white man. So you start to kind of oppress yourself in a sense where you're not being black, or just because you don't want to offend them, and more of like, I want to get my paycheck type of stuff. Does that make sense?
Oh, makes
so
perfect
like how
sense.
how do you because I'm like really trying to figure that out, like how do I survive in a world where it's like, okay, I'm already fighting being black, but then when my people that look like me are also in that sunken place, it makes it a little bit harder.
Well, you know, I'm going to talk about black people for a second. You can stay there, but let me say this. What I have noticed for every group, black people, people of color in general, women, poor people, disabled people, the LGBTQ community, any group that has ever been marginalized, disrespected, the victims of some form of discrimination and hate, there's a deep internalizing thing called self-hatred that goes on, you know? And it's profound. It says that that system of discrimination and oppression is working so well that it can step back and watch these people just destroy each other, hurt each other. You feel what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. That's what systems of oppression do, you know? And so when you talk about black folks, I mean, we have been deeply brainwashed. And just because you have a bachelor's degree or an AA or a master's degree or a PhD or no degree or a GED, whatever it is, it doesn't mean that you're self-loving. A lot of us are still self-hating, deeply self-hating. I mean, if in 2018, if you still got folks talking about someone's got good hair and someone's got bad hair, and you should be happy that you have hair, you know what I'm saying? And even if you don't have hair, it's still dope, because we make it dope, something's wrong. If you're still in 2018 making it seem like someone who is dark complexion, like you or my mother, is not as attractive, as beautiful, as handsome as someone who's lighter complexion, that's called self-hatred. You know, if you as a black person are African-American and you are West Indian and you're African, or you're from the East Coast and you're from the West Coast, or you're from the North and you're from the South, and y'all fighting each other. You're an Alpha, you're a Q, you're a Kappa, you're an Iota, you're a Delta, you're AK, and y'all fighting each other. That's called black self-hatred. I was at the school I was at in Pennsylvania the other day. I noticed a number of fraternity brothers of different fraternities, black fraternities. I belong to Alpha Phi Alpha. People can do whatever they want, but I'm going to keep it real with you because I know the history of slavery in this country. You better believe there's no brand on my body because I know that brands were used to identify slaves on plantations. You feel what I'm saying? Which is a form of self-hatred when you take something that was used on you during slavery and you use that on yourself when you're not a slave, quote unquote. Just like us calling ourselves the N-word out of slavery. You feel what I'm saying? And so the self-hatred is deep. When I got to Rutgers University, 18 years old, and I only got to college because of a financial aid package that was created because of the civil rights movement. All those folks were fighting for our rights as citizens and to vote, which is why I vote, which is why I vote, which is why I vote. You know what I mean? It also made it possible for me to go to college, to go to college, to go to college. I discovered what we call the E-185 section of the library where all the black history books are. Why is this important? If I'm black, if I'm Latina, if I'm Asian, if I'm a woman of any background, if I'm a poor person, whatever your background, you will be self-hating if you don't know anything about the history of who you are. You will be self-hating. It's just really basic. So the first 18 years of my life, in spite of being an A student, when I got out of high school, I won the math award and I won the English award. I got accepted to all four schools that I applied to, but I was profoundly self-hating. I wouldn't even look at a woman who was darker than me. You feel what I'm saying? Then I started reading Lerone Bennett's Before the Mayflower. I started reading Dr. Ivan Van Sertima. I read Frantz Fanon. I read Richard Wright. I read Baldwin. I read Zora Neale Hurston's Their Eyes Are Watching God. You know, unfortunately in college, most of the writers I got were male writers. It wasn't until after that I discovered this whole incredible body of literature of black women like Bell Hooks and Toni Morrison and Alice Walker, et cetera. But what I began to read, what I began to realize the more I read was how thoroughly the brainwashing was that taught me to hate myself. And I'm going to say it again, just because someone is in a leadership position or has a couple of degrees and all this other kind of stuff doesn't mean that they're immune from it. Every single one of us who is black in this room has been brainwashed with something called white supremacy. Period. And so if it's working on you 24/7, and it's working on white folks too, trust me, if it's sick for you to think that you're inferior and that you are, for us to be self-hating, imagine how sick it is for white folks to think they know everything and that they're superior. That's a sickness as well. That's a sickness. A superiority complex, a know-it-all complex, is a sickness as well. You know what I mean? And what I made a conscious decision, and I still battle with this, is like, I don't want to hate myself anymore just because I'm a black person. You know how you can tell black folks are self-hating? Even if there's no white folks around, and we're not saying anything offensive about white sisters and brothers, black folks just whisper the word, white, white people. And then look around to see if there's any white people. And I'm like, y'all laughing, but you know everyone in this room has done it. White people. And I actually checked one of my homeboys who used to talk all this stuff about black folks and how messed up we were. And then one day he just was like, white people. And I looked around. I said, bro, why'd you just whisper white people? He said, well, I don't want to offend nobody. I said, bro, there's no white people around. What are you afraid of? Because he was in that sunken place that you're talking about, that's talked about in the movie Get Out, where white supremacy is working all the time. And we don't even realize it. We think white supremacy is Charlottesville and these extremist KKK Clay folks. No, actually, it's the education everyone in this room got. If you were taught that Columbus discovered America, that George Washington never told a lie, and it's the father of this country, and they left out that he and Jefferson and most of the founding fathers were slave masters who did not believe in equality for anybody except for themselves as privileged straight white males, then you were brainwashed. If you believe that Lincoln really truly loved the slaves and really wanted the freedom, instead of the fact that he was actually going back and forth, it was actually about convenience because they were going to lose the Civil War if we didn't get black folks into the army, then you've been brainwashed. You know what I'm saying? I mean, think about how Serena Williams is treated, the greatest tennis player and one of the greatest athletes ever. Her entire career as a beautiful, dark-skinned, fully formed black woman has been scrutinized. Everything from her hair to her nails to how she dresses to one of her uniforms being banned in France the other day. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Anything to try to, because the way racism operates is about trying to control us over and over again. And then some of us are so brainwashed into that controlling that we will do it amongst ourselves. You know how I know? I spoke in Indiana a few years back at a Dr. King program. I don't think I said anything out of the extraordinary. I had black folks come up to me, not the white folks. The white folks were like, thank you, Kevin, we appreciate you. The black folks were some scared Negroes. Oh, you know they're not gonna invite you here ever again, sir. I said, really, why not? Well, what you said, well, what did I say? You know, about Dr. King, I said, well, actually, I was quoting Dr. King from 1965 to 1968, the radical Dr. King, the evolutionary Dr. King that they don't want to tell you about. I'm using Dr. King's words. Well, I'm just saying, they're not gonna invite you back here again. Just for the record, y'all, I'll be back in Indianapolis in October, I'm just saying. But I'm just like, so my point is, don't worry about the scared black folks. You be who you are. Be your authentic self, love yourself, know that you're brilliant, you're beautiful, you're powerful, you can do anything you want with your life. You come from an incredible tradition, not slavery, going all the way back to ancient Africa, which is the cradle of civilization for the rest of the world. That's who you are. And if some folks don't want to believe that, that's on them. In fact, by a show of hands, how many folks here are African? Anybody here African? That's the problem right there. The whole world comes from Africa. So everyone in this room is self-hating because you don't even know that the whole world started in Africa. That's my point. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hey, how you doing?
Peace.
Thank you. Thank you for being here today. And,
thank you all for having
appreciate
me.
Appreciate you.
Appreciate you.
For what you do.
I appreciate what you do. Well, what do you do? Who are you?
I do a lot of things, but I graduated here back in 02.
Okay.
And transferred up to BYU and finished up my degree there in psychology. And I'm born and raised here, and I was actually raised by my grandparents and in a black household.
Yes, sir.
And I grew up, and I asking my grandmother, so grandma, what's the difference between the Democrats and the Republicans? And I always remember this answer. She said, well, Democrats are for the poor people, and Republicans are for the rich people.
Hmm.
And that's how I grew up thinking.
Yes, sir.
And so I kind of thought about how I've actually voted once in my life.
Just 30, once?
35 years old. I voted once in my life, and that was just for Obama.
And what year?
The first time.
The first time.
The first time, yeah. And that was just because he was black.
That's
that
honest.
He was black. Yeah,
a lot of people said that,
black.
Though.
So it's like I look at all the different presidents. You know, I was born with Ronald Reagan. You know, I look at, you know, Clinton, Bush, all of the presidents, and I just look at my life, and it's just the same. You know, with every president, my life hasn't changed. And I become apathetic to voting.
To I respect that.
Where it's just
that.
Like, I don't, you know, I just don't see, you know, I just don't see the, you know, the difference. I also see the, you know, the purpose of it.
I understand.
So when I seen your forum on Facebook, I was like, you know what, I'm gonna go check that out.
Were you here for the whole thing?
I was here for most of it. I was late.
What part you came in on?
When you started talking about voting.
Oh.
I came in.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
But my question for you is how can a person like me change? Like, I want to change. I want to be, you know, I want to be like a leader, like you're talking about being. Like, how can I change? Like, what can I read or what can I do?
Wow. Well, you know, let's give him a round of applause. The honesty. See, these are the kind of community conversations that I want to have because, you know, I don't want to be in a town hall meeting where, first of all, I've been in places where they ask people to write questions down and you got to read it. I want to hear the people speak. That's real democracy, number one. Number two, I respect the fact that you said you don't care about it. You know what I mean? Because it takes courage to do that. Because I know a lot of folks who don't care about it. Most of my homies in New York are like, son, I ain't voting for nobody. They're the same people all the time. You know what? They're absolutely right. It's like, it's just the same people straight down the line. Have you noticed that in Arizona as well? You know? And so I get it. You know, what I'm saying is that for cultural, historical, spiritual, moral reasons, that's why I honor my mother and my ancestors. But that's just who I am. I can't make you into me. I'm saying I acknowledge the history that led to me to just have the opportunity to do this. You know, but I'd also be lying to you in New York City. Even when I ran for Congress in 2008, 2010, it's like, you know, I just see the same stuff. And you're right. The way it operates is if you don't have enough money, people are not going to support you. It's ridiculous. And then in that sense, there's not a lot of difference between the Democrats and Republicans because political parties, these two parties have become about money, 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 money. And I'm saying this is someone who not only has run for office, but has, you know, a consulted many campaigns, supported many campaigns. I'm supporting campaigns right now. But at the same time, I realized that this is not really a democracy that we live under. It's actually an oligarchy. Democracy means one person, one vote. Well, how is it a democracy when the presidential election is decided by Electoral College? You know, and who are those people? You know, we don't even know who they are half the time. You feel what I'm saying? That's not a democracy, that's an oligarchy. An oligarchy is when, you know, if you don't have enough money, you know, you don't win. But, you know, we have an example of a Latina sister in New York, Sister Alexandria, who just won a congressional seat in the Bronx and Queens, these two boroughs, and she didn't have anywhere near the money of the incumbent candidate, but what she did have is the organization and the love of the people in the community. That's why she won that nomination. You feel what I'm saying? And New York is a Democratic city. It ain't got nothing to do with Republicans in New York City. Upstate Republicans, Long Island Republicans, but not New York City. But even in New York City, the Democrats are as crooked as they claim the Republicans to be. I know that for a fact as someone who is deeply entrenched in the political system there. So I understand what you're saying. So part of it, bringing it back to Dr. King, is that we need a radical revolution of values across the board. And that certainly includes the political spectrum. You know, while I'm happy that Brother Gillum got the Democratic nomination in Florida and that Stacey Abrams, may very well be the first black woman governor of the state of Georgia come November, and I certainly support Beto O'Rourke in Texas, who's dynamic. If I have not watched his speech about his support of football players protesting, is a brilliant speech. But I can't deny the fact that for every Beto and Andrew and Stacey Abrams in Georgia, I'm running into a lot of people who are just career politicians. It's the truth. Who turn off people like you because they just are there because it's a career move. In New York, we got a lot of folks who just run and then they get term limited in one seat, then they go to another seat, and you don't really see a track record. What I'm looking for, if you're gonna be a politician, elected official, when Ted Kennedy died in 2009, you know, in spite of all we could say about Ted Kennedy, the thing that stuck out to me was that 400 bills were tied to Ted Kennedy's name as a U.S. Senator from the state of Massachusetts. He put in work. Adam Clayton Powell, the great congressman, our alpha brother from Harlem, when he was congressman, he helped to pass so many legislation that benefited people like me, which is one reason why I was able to go to college. You feel what I'm saying? And so, you know, I say, brother, like Gandhi said, be the change that you want to see. If you don't like what's there, then you replace it. You become a part of it. You become someone who, you become the leader that you want to see. What do you need to do? You need to know history. You know what I'm saying? You got to know this history of this country. I'm going to say it again, two books. Howard Zinn's A People's History of the United States. Howard Zinn, A People's History of the United States. Read that book. Well, who was Howard Zinn? Howard Zinn was a white brother, a Jewish brother, who participated in the Civil Rights Movement in the 1960s. He was captivated by this movement. He was also blown away by the fact that these black folks were doing all this dynamic work. He realized not only did he not know anything about black folks in America, he didn't really know anything about the history of America. I want to actually help create a real history. And one of the things he says in the introduction of his book, as a white brother, this is an ally to me. I'm writing from the perspective of the people who have been left out. That's how you tell history. Now, I'm not going to write from the perspective of the explorers and the settlers and the pilgrims. We've heard those stories before. Those are racist stories. Those are stories that leave out people purposely. So that book, and then for black history, a simple text, Lerone Bennett Before the Mayflower. Lerone Bennett Before the Mayflower. Hoover's Lerone Bennett. He was a great writer and editor for Ebony Magazine for like 50 years. And he purposely told history stories that black folks needed to know. So you drive a car?
Yes, sir.
So you know the next time you stop at a traffic light, you think about the black man who created the traffic light. You feel what I'm saying? The next time you're under some lights like this, don't think just about Thomas Edison. Think about Louis Latimer, who worked with Thomas Edison, a black man. You feel what I'm saying? The next time you go to Washington, D.C., think about Benjamin Banneker, a black man who was a contemporary of George Washington and Alexander Hamilton and Thomas Jefferson, who created the grid for the city of Washington, D.C. You feel what I'm saying? You know, you think about Frederick Douglass, who is the most photographed person in America in the 19th century, even more than Abraham Lincoln, and I would argue had more of an impact on America than Abraham Lincoln ever did, you know? So I think that part of it is rooting yourself in history, and then are you involved in any organizations in this community, sir?
I'm not.
That's part of it. You know, you got Kappas, you got Alphas, you got NAACP, you got a whole bunch of organizations here. You got to join something. You got to be a part of something. I can't speak for anybody else, but you know, one of the things I say to my wife all the time, I have to be a part of communities. You know, what do? You join communities. I'm a part of the hip-hop community. I'm a part of the activist community. I'm a part of a yoga community. I'm a vegan. My wife is a vegan. We're part of vegan communities. You feel what I'm saying? You know, I believe in being a part. I'm part of mental health communities. I talk openly about the need for therapy and going to therapy and wanting to get back to therapy. I want to be a part of communities of people. You know what I'm saying? Because that's, you know, we can't operate by ourselves. I'm not into this whole social Darwinism thing that we were taught in the school system growing up, which I think is destructive. I'm an only child. I'm a writer. I am, in some ways, an introvert. I like being alone, but I also need people. How many of y'all know what I'm talking about? I need people. You know what I mean? I need people, you know, because otherwise we just become isolated and disillusioned and, as you put it, apathetic. And people give me energy, you know? I love it, man. And that's what I think we got to do. And if you decide you want to vote, you have that right. But I'm also going to say to you, because I think it's the Democratic thing to say, if you don't want to vote, you have that right as well. And most folks won't say that to you. What we try to do is we guilt trip people, we badger people, we beat people down, or we'll say things like, you're the reason why Trump is in office. I hate it when people do that. I think that's disrespectful to our ancestors as much as people not voting. When you badger and disrespect people, democracy means that you can do what you feel like doing. You know what I'm saying? All I'm saying is you need to know the history and be aware of this history, because it may actually influence you to think about it a little differently. But if you still decide you don't want to vote, that's your right, man. I'm not into that, because otherwise I become as oppressive as the oppression I claim to be against. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
First, I want to thank you for your time and coming
thank
out.
Thank you for having me.
And I want to thank Walita Hicks for making sure to invite me.
Thank you, Ms. Hicks.
And I am a student here at Phoenix College, and I'm returning after like 20 years because I was a teenage mother. And so I decided to come back.
You were a teenage mother, you said?
I was a teenage mother.
Yes, ma'am.
And so that they became my focus and working.
I'm glad you're back.
So I came here because I'm just like you. Like, I've always loved to read, but I did grow up. My grandmother was born in the 41.
Yes, ma'am.
And she was very, like your mother. And
old school.
Old school.
Yeah.
I always held my thoughts in, and now I'm coming into finding my voice.
Yes.
So now that I'm getting out into the community more, I came here just like the gentleman before me. I had lost hope in the voting system after the Trump election.
Hmm.
I was actually excited that I did not have the right to vote because I didn't really want to vote for either.
Hmm.
But my right to vote was taken, and I came to get the knowledge to help.
When you say your right to vote was taken, can you?
I don't currently have the right to vote because of a felony.
I understand.
And it's a felony that you look at almost every other corner up the street, you'll find a dispensary, and
yes,
you know, they're making money, and I have a
marijuana
felony too. So
yep.
So I don't have the right to vote, but I did want to come and spark that passion because I did enjoy voting when I had the right. So I appreciate your words and bringing that passion back, that it is important, because I really just had lost hope. What's the point of voting? What's the point in telling people to vote?
Yes, ma'am.
But since I don't have the right, I do want to get out and spread that importance. But like you said, it's definitely their choice. But just, you know, for people that do feel like myself or the young man before, just the importance of voting and my question is, what kind of advice would you give me?
Wow, great. No, thank you. Stay right there, please. And I'm good on, we good? I'm good on time if y'all good on time. I figure with the president here, we can stay as long as we want, right? You gotta go? President's like, I gotta go soon. I need to say this. When we talk about racism, the racism of the criminal justice system is unfathomable. How many people I know of color, black and brown people, who have been sent to jail for marijuana? You know what I'm saying? And I know plenty of white sisters and brothers who have not experienced that at all, you know? And, you know, what do we need from that? We need not just people of color to protest, but we need white allies who are gonna stand up more to say, hey, this is unacceptable, this discrepancy in penalizing people. There's also, you know, I know the cannabis industry is blowing up in this country, but I also think that there's racism in the cannabis industry because, you know, the reality is if you come from poor communities like I come from poor communities, I mean, let's keep it 100, y'all. Black folks been selling weed forever. Latino folks been selling weed forever. I'm not, you know, it's not, can we say no judgment? Can we say no judgment?
No judgment.
And safe space? Unless you come from poverty the way I do, don't judge poor people for selling drugs, from swinging from poles, from doing things that we do for economic reasons. Let's be real about this. You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, we know that now that the cannabis industry has become this financial well, that a lot of folks don't, y'all all right? A financial well, you know, all of a sudden a lot of us are having a hard time getting in there. It's almost like any other business, like black folks can't get in or Latino folks can't get into the cannabis industry, which is crazy to me. There's racism there. And if you're in it and you notice that there's not a lot of people of color with business opportunities, you have a responsibility to challenge that right here in Arizona, other places. I need to say that. And then, you know, around this voting issue, I think that y'all got to organize. There are people who organize in other states. I think it's unfair for someone who's a formerly incarcerated person, you know, to not have the right to vote. You already paid your time. You already did your time. You know, I think it's unfair. I think it's unjust to take voting away, but I also think it's purposeful because most of the people who are incarcerated in this country are people of color, and a lot of these states take away the right of people of color to vote after they're incarcerated. It's a way to keep them from voting and participating in the process so they can keep themselves in positions of power. Y'all feel where I'm going with this? This is what it is. And so what can you do? I would say organize with other folks who are formerly incarcerated persons, women, men, however they identify themselves gender-wise or no gender identity whatsoever. And like, you know, we need to fight for our right to vote. It's real simple. I'm gonna say this to y'all. Y'all should not just give up the state of Arizona. I do believe that there's good people in this state. I've met a lot of beautiful and powerful people in this state. And I see some stuff happening here that I feel like there's potential here to change this state around. You know, again, you know, I don't care if people are Democrats or Republicans, but I do care that every human being has an opportunity to have an opportunity in Arizona, in New York, and all around this country. And that is simply not the case. It's slanted against certain people. We know that's real. And so I think that organize, 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 and you just got to figure out what is my passion? You know, what is it that, you know, is it women who are formerly incarcerated? Is it all gender identities are formerly incarcerated? You know, is it the issue of voting? You know, you decide what it is, and you got organizations right here in this room that are doing that work, and you link up with those folks, and you become the leader that we need. And I'm glad you asked this question. This is for everybody. We got to stop saying stuff like there's no leaders. We gotta stop saying stuff, well, Dr. King or Bobby Kennedy, guess what? They are never coming back. They're never coming back. Cesar Chavez is never coming back. The leadership we are waiting for, per the Civil Rights Movement title, theme, that phrase, is us, you know? And so I think that everything that we talked about tonight, hashtag read, study, travel, you are that leader you're waiting for. You just got to identify what it is, and then you got to become excellent at it. And what I say to you, I want to use an example really quickly before you leave of a formerly incarcerated person. His name was Malcolm X. He had an eighth grade education. Have you ever read the autobiography of Malcolm X, cover to cover? No. Read the autobiography of Malcolm X, cover to cover. I don't care what your gender identity is, but for you especially, since you know, you were honest enough to share who you are, this man gets locked up for 7 years. He realized when he got to prison that he could not even read his own handwriting because his education had been so stunted, right? Malcolm X was a product, a victim of the foster care system and how it divided his family apart. His father had been killed by the Ku Klux Klan, his body thrown on a railroad track and split in half. This is where Malcolm X came from. Little wonder he ended up hustling on the streets trying to survive, ended up in jail. In jail, this man starts reading the dictionary. Started with the letter A, the word aardvark. When he got out of jail, he had found his voice and became one of the most dynamic voices we have ever heard in world history, not just American history, world history. And if he could do it, you can do it. You feel me?
Definitely.
Thank you.
And I just wanted to thank you also. I want to thank you because I stopped recently going to actual church, but this is church to me, and I wanted to, because I'm just tired of the lies. I thank you for keeping it 100%.
Thank you.
And bringing the truth to
Thank
us.
Thank you so much. Wow. Yes, yes.
Hello.
Hey.
Hi. I'm going to try to push through my anxiety because I'm
shaking. Is that Stuart Roden out there? Stuart, what's up, bro? I just recognize. I'm sorry, ma'am. What's your name?
My name's Tian Watkins.
Ms. Watkins.
I'm a student here.
Yes, ma'am.
A little bit about me, I'll keep it brief, was that I was born, my dad is white, my mom is black.
Yes, ma'am.
And so I was the firstborn, and I'm, you know, in a mixed family.
Yeah.
Politics wasn't really huge for me. It was kind of just one of those like, oh, you know, you're a kid and then you'll learn later. It wasn't until the Trump election when, I was born in September, so I was learning about the voting system and why we vote and who we're gonna vote for. And I personally didn't like either candidate, and I kind of felt that this election was like a joke. I was like, are you serious? These are who I have to pick from, and it was frustrating. I voted, and after that vote, I have many friends from all races and everything. I've noticed that my friends who were people of color don't talk to me because my dad is white, and who's in office, I was told I'm racist, I'm homophobic, I'm all things that I think is very odd to call me when I've never expressed any of that. And so now, you know, seeing my family and seeing how politics has really started to divide the people I'm related to by blood, it's saddening. And being in college, I love Phoenix College, by the way, seeing all the diversity that we see, I feel very welcome. But for someone like me who I feel has always kind of fell in the middle with everything, with politics, with all types of things, how would you find a voice for me, someone with horrible anxiety and doesn't really see this race is better, I find it hard to want to side one way, and I don't really want to side one way or another when it's my family. If that makes sense.
It makes perfect sense. Mm-hmm. Wow. Thank you for your honesty. These are great questions and comments. Well, I say to you what I say to everyone, no matter who we are, love all parts of yourself. Love all parts of yourself. Love all parts of yourself. You know, you are unique. I believe inside of you, because as you said, you are part white and part black, makes you a natural bridge builder, actually. You know, you can relate to a wide range of people just because you've had to do it in your own family, you know. I think it's also important to understand that on the people of color side, quote unquote, that there's historical hurt that exists for some very valid reasons. And most of us carry these traumas, these pains around, and never deal with it in any way. I can tell you from my own personal experiences, when I got to college and I started reading all this black history stuff I was talking about earlier, black history, I stopped eating white bread. I stopped drinking white milk. I'm being serious. I got extreme. I was like, I ain't nothing white. And I would walk down College Avenue, our main strip at Rutgers University in New Jersey, and I would purposely bump into the white students. And the moment they said, I'm sorry, I would say to them, you should be sorry for what you've done to black people for the last 400 years. And the white folks was like, yo, because they had no idea what I was talking about. You know, because they weren't woke, just like I wasn't woke about 2 hours before I read some book, you know what I'm saying? But I'm saying to you, that was part of the journey. Unfortunately, some of us get stuck there in that reactionary anger. There's nothing wrong with being angry, but there's proactive anger and there's reactionary anger. And at some point, I had to realize, hey, man, you can't go around hating people, even if you believe some people hate you, or there's systems that hate you because of who you are, you know? And it's still a struggle. I mean, my wife and I talk about it all the time. It's hard being a black person or a person of color in this country because you feel it. Am I right, y'all? You feel it from every angle. At work, you know, one of the few safe spaces we have is church, you know, and for a lot of us. So I get that. But I also think that I think the conversation needs to happen on both sides, because I think that also white sisters and brothers need to understand, whether you're a poor white person or a middle-class white person or a wealthy white person, you benefit from something called skin privilege in this country, you know? And you have a choice. Do you want to participate in that skin privilege, or do you actually want to be an ally and fight against that skin privilege? Do you know what I'm saying? You know, and so I don't think it's actually effective to be in the middle and be neutral. I actually think that you have to be an active agent talking with both sides about what they can be doing and how they can both move forward and heal. And I think it's a necessary conversation, I believe. Because you have a unique situation. I mean, some of us have family members I have family members who are married to people who are interracial marriages. I have no issue with interracial marriages whatsoever. Love is love. If you love someone, you love someone. But what I do say is that interracial marriage should be having some honest conversations about these issues in this country. Otherwise, you're living in some sort of illusion. You know, like, we don't see race. When people say, I don't see race, I don't see color, I'm like, you're living an illusionary life in America, because it's very real. So I think that that's what it is. I think, but it also back to what I said to other people, you got to arm yourself with as much information as possible so you have a way of articulating to both sides, hey, you know, we need to think about this, you know? And I do think it's possible. I think it's possible to move the needle with people. My mother, who for years was very disrespectful to Latino people, you know what I mean? Because she came from a world in the South that are black and white people only. When she saw that I was not relinquishing my friendships, my love for my Latina friends, she started coming around, you know, and started seeing the humanity in the Latina community. You know what I mean? Because I wasn't going to compromise what I felt. This was important to me. So I think that you've got to take some stand on some things with both sides. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Thank you.
Can you be the last person? And we're going to sign some books, buy some books, y'all. We take debit, credit cards, EBT cards and stuff.
Yes?
No, we don't take EBT cards. Yes, I'm sorry.
Hi, Kevin. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Esteban Bahinas. I'm a student here at Phoenix College. Before I actually ask my question, I want to preface it with saying that I very much so enjoyed your speech. Lecture, whatever you want to call it. It was very enticing. I also very enjoyed how you said violent and abusive. And that this is actually very surreal for me because the first introduction that I had to you was actually watching the documentary, The Evolution of Hip Hop. And that was so much fun.
Was that the one on Netflix?
The one, yep, okay. That's the one.
I've never seen it, but thank you.
It's really good.
Okay, thank you.
But my actual question would be, how can we as individuals of our own community come together or use our individual voices to do things that we want to do to help our communities or these establishments that we believe are worth helping to go forth of our communities?
Oof. I mean, you know, I need to say this, Dean Thompson, Dr. Johnson, Dr. Westenberg, everyone here, Ms. Hicks, y'all have some brilliant students at this school, just brilliant students at Phoenix College. I just need to say that, because these are really profound questions. I'm going to say this. It's hard work working in our communities. It's thankless work at times. I mean, I love doing it. I have many frustrations, many disappointments. It hurts a lot. You know, I had some hurtful moments just today, to be honest with you, for some phone calls I dealt with. But I do it because I care and I feel that it's important, you know? And I feel like if you truly are woke, you can't just turn off, you can't just become unwoke once you become woke. You can't go back, you know what I'm saying? I think, you know, I do it now more than ever. Not expecting thank yous, not expecting anything. Just like, you know, I just want to do this. I just want to help. I even gotten to a point now where I say to people, well, how can I be of service and no need to thank me? Or the best way you can thank me is just go help somebody else when you can. You know what I'm saying? And I say the same thing, you know, find the things that matter to you. Like for me, this will be my 18th year, for example, that I'm doing a clothing drive for homeless young people in New York City. That matters to me. Why does it matter to me? Because in my early 20s, there were times where I had nowhere to live and I was just bouncing around. And so, you know, you ask yourself, like, what are the issues that you care about? What are the two or three things that matter to you most?
Animals.
Then you got to fight for the rights of animals. That's what you got to do. That's what you gotta do. I mean, I get it, I'm a vegan. I don't like to see harm to animals at all. I'm struggling with my wife bringing her dogs back. I'm gonna learn to love them. I'm gonna work on that. You know what I mean? But I think that's important. And that becomes your issue then. And then you educate people like me about it. Like, what is one thing you would say to the audience that we need to think about in terms of animals?
I would say the way we treat them, the way we treat them is a reflection of how we would treat others. The way you care for your dog or cat is how you want to be treated, the way you should treat other people.
Thank you. Well said. Thank you so much. Wow.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, y'all can't ask the questions? Yeah. Can we do it here, though? Can we do it right here real quick?
Hello. I wanted to say first, thank you so much for coming. I really enjoyed your talk.
Thank you. You're a student here as well?
Yes, I am. I'm one of those that's never too late.
That's right.
Yes.
What are you studying?
I'm studying interior design.
Oh, good.
Yes.
So you like making stuff look beautiful.
Yes, that's what my mother said.
Okay.
Yes, when I woke up.
That's right. What's your name?
My name is Denise.
Miss Denise, all right.
So I wanted to share with you, my mother was actually born in 1936 in the segregated South. And she was actually part of the SNCC at her college.
Oh, wow.
At Knoxville College.
SNCC.
Yeah.
Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. At what college?
At Knoxville College.
Okay, wow, wow.
Ironically, she actually studied at Knoxville College, but at University of Tennessee, actually where my future father-in-law was going to school, the faculty there allowed the black students at Knoxville College to study in their library. And then decades later, my husband and I met. That's my daughter that you
hey,
that you spoke
that's your
to.
Daughter?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Okay.
So I grew up, you know, with my mom sharing a little bit about what she went through during the sit-ins, during the time in the segregated South. Her parents actually sent her to boarding school because she was the child that would ask, why do we have to drink out of this water fountain? Mm. Why are we not allowed in the restaurant? And my grandparents were actually afraid for her life that she would say this publicly and something would happen to her. So they actually sent her away to school to protect her.
Where did they send her to? Do you know?
She went to, oh gosh, I can't.
Was it in Mississippi by any chance?
It was in Georgia. I cannot think of the name.
That's all right.
I'm sorry. But anyway, so all that. To say, I'm currently reading a book called Difficult Conversations, and you mentioned that we have a hard time, whether it's social media, face-to-face, the disrespect that people show to one another.
Yes, ma'am.
So my question to you is, how would you encourage us to have respectful, difficult conversations with one another? I just recently wrote a very respectful letter to President Trump. Talking about the violence that's going on in cities like Chicago, where we seem to just turn a blind eye and say things like, well, that's Chicago.
Right.
I listed very specific points. It's not a conversation. I went on the White House's website, and it said that the current president, every single letter that's written to the president is read by someone, and those people select 10 letters a day, and they give those letters to the president to read personally in the evening. So I thought, okay, a book of stamps is $10. I'm gonna print 20 letters and sign 20 letters to increase the chances that one of the people that are gonna read the letter would actually give that letter to President Trump. I haven't heard back yet. But my question to you is, so how would you encourage us to have respectful, difficult conversations with one another?
Do it. Create spaces like this and do it. You know, invite people. I feel like there's some things here tonight I'm sure folks haven't been comfortable with. Am I right, y'all? Mm-hmm. I'm sure. I just say what I feel. You know, ain't no cursing up here. Ain't no putting people down. But, you know, and people have a right to say things. You know, when the brother said he's apathetic about voting, you know, I've been in spaces where I've seen people like him shouted down. I would not tolerate that here. I'm like, he has a right to say what he feels. I think that's being respectful. Wouldn't you agree?
Yes.
You know, and so, and if someone got up and said, well, I don't agree with all the stuff you said, Kevin. If someone said, you know, I'm pro-guns, I'm anti-abortion, I would have said, you have a right to your opinion. Mm-hmm. You know, and I would have said, you know, well, tell us about your opinion. And here's why I don't agree with it, but we can agree to disagree civilly. That's what I would say.
Okay.
I think that there's a way to have civil dialogue. I think it's the tone that we set. You know, I feel like from the moment that the program started, there was a civil and respectful tone that was here, you know, and I just think that you have to create that space. You have to be willing. You're a leader, right?
Yes.
Then you create that space. You know, the way your daughter spoke about, you know, the issues that she spoke about, I think that was very powerful. And because I've evolved, I'm like, you know what? You have a right to be who you are. Whatever identities you want to claim, you should be all those things and be proud of it. I think you got to be in spaces where people respect that, you know, and set that tone. I don't want to be in a space where people are being put down because they're biracial or because they're queer or because they're poor or they're this or that. No, we don't. Do y'all want to be a part of that? I don't want to be a part of that.
No.
And so I think that we got to create those spaces. All this ugliness that we see out there that's dominating the news is because these folks have created spaces where it's okay to yell and curse and destroy, literally try to destroy people. And, you know, people always ask me, Kev, how come I don't see you on CNN, all these places all the time? I said, because I stopped wanting to be on these places because I don't want to be on TV just yelling back and forth with people. I had a debate on, I think it was Fox News or one of the channels a couple years ago with, not Laura Ingraham. What's the other woman that goes off? She has blonde hair. And she just,
they all have blonde hair.
They all have blonde hair, she said.
Is it? Megyn Kelly. Now she's with NBC. But
it was someone, and you know what? I yelled at her on TV, and it's something I don't do. And I just said, man, I don't want to be that person on TV. I said, I got to get away from this. So I just think you got to struggle. We all got to struggle. I still struggle with it. Like, how do you have civil conversations with each other? With our partners, with our families, with our families. And I think it's practice, and have the ability of, if my wife or someone else says, hey, Kev, I didn't like the way you talked to me, even if my ego gets in the way, I got to step back and say, I need to hear what they're saying, And if they're right, I need to check this. I need to think about this. It's not easy. But I think that we've got to struggle to have those kind of conversations, because the alternative is just ugly, more ugliness, over and over again.
I like what you said when you said, tell me why you think that way. Thank you for that. I appreciate it.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you so much. Yes.
Hello, Mr. Powell.
Kevin.
Oh, hello, Mr. Kevin. My name is Christian.
He just called
Ruiz.
Me just Kevin. I like that. What's up?
Oh, what's up? My name is Christian Ruiz, and I'm actually in high school. I'm a senior in high school.
Oh, that's what's up.
Yes.
What high school?
Shadow Ridge. We all the way down Surprise, like way far away. Drove out here.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah, for sure. And I was just, I guess I'll just start off by saying I'm really passionate about the hip-hop culture. And actually, I took this summer, really, in this past year, I took in a lot of time to study hip-hop. And not just because, I remember when I was younger, my uncle, he used to play Tupac and all the West Coast classics all the time, and Jay-Z and all them. And like,
how old are you?
I'm 17.
That's
I'm turning
what's
18
up.
That soon. Okay. But yeah. And then like, I just realized, because my uncle, he's a big influence on me, and he started becoming, I guess, more woke, right? He's the one that introduced me to all these social issues, because he went to college recently too.
Oh, good.
And so then through that, I'm like, well, if I love this music so much, what's the story behind it? And then when you're talking about Kool Herc, and then all them, and the Bronze, African Bambaataa, all that, I was like, I connected with that, and I'm like, yeah, I learned all about that. And so I guess my question comes right here. As a Latino man, I guess it's been hard for me to find a identity, because I'm learning about hip hop, and like, I guess it's always been, I guess, associated with just a black culture, people of color culture.
Right.
And so like, I find myself difficult sometimes. I can't really relate to my Latino culture, because I can understand Spanish, can't speak it very well, and also I don't really know, I guess, my roots as a Latino.
What country is your family from, generation?
El Salvador.
El Salvador.
Yeah. So
the great El Salvador.
Yeah.
Right on.
So then, I feel like because I've become very knowledgeable on just social issues in general,
Right.
I've been trying to make it real, that's like my purpose, right?
Yes.
And so then I feel like I'm not credible to the black community, because I'm a Latino man. That's how I feel sometimes. And I guess my question to you is, as a Latino man, how can I reach all people of color?
Wow, 17. I was not thinking like you at 17. First of all. So, master Spanish, learn Spanish, become fluent, learn the history of El Salvador, very important, Latin American history is incredible, incredible, rich. And there's so many things that come out of Latin American history that are part of hip-hop culture. If you get a chance, there's something called the Hispanic Heritage Awards, which for the Latino, Latinx communities, like the NAACP Image Awards. My friend Antonio Tejerino, who's from Nicaragua, is the CEO of the Hispanic Heritage Foundation. And I have been talking to him for the last couple of years. I say, Antonio, man, y'all got to do a tribute to the history, the contributions of the Latinx community to hip hop. So they're finally doing it. They're going to honor Crazy Legs, one of the legendary dancers out of New York, Puerto Rican brother this year. Fat Joe's going to present the award to him. And then they're going to be bringing together a diverse group of folks to do this tribute. And so I would say, you got to start digging into El Salvadorian culture, the larger Latino, Latina, Latinx diaspora, just like we say the African diaspora, the Latinx diaspora, learn all that history. It's important, and learn it from your perspective, not from the perspective of, American policy and stuff like that, but understand, like, what was El Salvador, and I'm sure, you're going to learn, well, maybe I have indigenous blood in me, mixed with African blood, it might be mixed with European blood, it might be all mixed together, it's a rich history, and I think that also understand, that there would be no hip-hop without the Latinx community. There would be no hip-hop without the Latinx community. I can say this because I literally was a youth in the late 70s, early 80s, and if it wasn't for the Latinx community, specifically with graffiti and dancing, the Latino community held down dancing graffiti. There's four core elements to hip hop: MC, the DJ, graffiti writing, the dance element. Brothers, black brothers, we wanted to be on the mic. We wanted to be like, yo, son, throw your hands in the air. You know, and there were Latino rappers, but it was mostly black Americans, you know. And the rapper got put to the forefront, which is why people think this culture is all black people. But I'm telling you, because I was there, the dopest dancers were the Latino dancers. The dopest visual artists, graffiti writers, were the Latino visual artists. I'm telling you that for a fact, you know what I mean? That's important to acknowledge, man. Were you here when I talked about the influence of the Chicano culture?
Yeah, I was here for the whole thing.
Yeah, I mean, on the West Coast, I mean, you can't talk about West Coast hip-hop. There's so many influences, of course, but it's a mixture of things. And so it's not about trying to prove anything to black folks. It's about loving and honoring yourself. And the black folks who are really woke, like me, get it. And we're like, you are my brother. You're my family. You know what I mean? Mi familia. You know what I'm saying? That's the way I look at it. Anyone else who says any kind of stuff, those folks don't need, they're not allies, you know what I mean? Me and Crazy Legs, that's my boy, so it was a no-brainer when Antonio said to me, well, who should be on? I was like, Crazy Legs is a global ambassador for hip-hop, man. This Puerto Rican brother has been holding it down. He's been all over the world because of his culture. You know, this Puerto Rican boy from the Bronx has been around the world, and he represents it, you know, but he also talks about the influence of all these different things on hip-hop, including, you know, the Latino influence, the African influence, all of it. So I think you just got to study the history. Study the history, man. I think, you know, one of the brothers said it, someone said it, watched Evolution of Hip Hop on Netflix.
Yeah, I did. That's where, like, I started my
I guess. You know, there's plenty of books, like Jeff Chang's book, Asian American brother who's from Hawaii, who wrote a book, you know, Can't Stop, Won't Stop. There's a book by David Toop called Rap Attack, which is a great book. Nelson George wrote a book called Hip Hop America. I did a hip hop photo book called Who Shot You with the Native American photographer Ernie Panicoli. We could exchange emails and I'd give you a whole bunch of stuff.
I would really appreciate that.
And you know what's crazy too? I just sent in a book proposal for a history of hip hop for young adults that I might be doing in a couple years after the Tupac book.
Yeah.
You know, because we need to share this history with each other. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I appreciate it. Because my uncle actually, after he graduated, he's trying to work towards that, trying to, like, bring hip-hop, I guess, to college and, like, trying to make that to the forefront to teach it to you know, people of color, like youth of color.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I would love if we could exchange information.
Definitely. And hip-hop is taught all over the country, man. You know, and I know a lot of folks who don't get it, but I'm like, hey, hip-hop is as vital to us as jazz is. Like, it's a serious study to us, you know what I mean? Because it's When we produced the hip hop exhibit and brought it to the Brooklyn Museum, when 500,000 people came to the Brooklyn Museum and it broke all the records for Brooklyn Museum, I was like, this is crazy. This is our culture, you know, that people are coming to see. It was people of all backgrounds. But people like you created it. That's what I'm saying to you. And you need to be a part of it and really take ownership with it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Cool?
Yeah.
Thank you. The last person. Word.
Hi.
Hey.
Thank you for being here. I'm Talanya Adams. Congratulations on your congressional run.
That was 8 years ago.
Well, you
I
ran.
Lost.
You ran.
I did run.
Yeah.
I lost twice.
I just ran a race too, and the numbers are coming in, and I'm losing. So.
Oh, what did you run
so
for?
So there's that.
What did you run for?
The Arizona State House.
Was it your first time running?
It was my first time running statewide.
Okay. Did you raise a lot of money?
I ran as a clean election candidate, and so I had decent money.
Okay.
Yeah.
Didn't run it. You going to run again?
That's a great question. That's a great question.
It takes a lot out of you, doesn't it?
It does take a lot out of you, which kind of begs the question. I was sitting here as I was listening to the girl that talked about being a felon, and I really appreciate her honesty.
Oh, hey.
Where is she?
Right there.
Yeah. Much respect to you.
Yes.
I needed to collect signatures, as you know, to get my name on the ballot. And day in and day out, I met many people. I'm a lawyer. So I met many people that when they found out I was a lawyer, they would say to me, I'm a felon. How do I get my rights restored?
Yes.
But not prior to that.
Yes.
And I think we need criminal justice reform in this state where we have private prisons publicly traded on the New York Stock Exchange.
Yes.
And 90% guaranteed occupancy rates,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
But my question is, as it relates to talking about the power to vote, also talking about the power of participating in building infrastructure.
Yes.
Right? Of third-party advocates, whether you're a felon or not, right? You're a felon, you don't have a right to vote, You can run for office, right? You are still an American citizen,
that's a great
right?
point.
I mean, that's incredible, right?
That's a great
there are
point.
All there. There is a huge spectrum of participation. Yes, let's do talk because I'm doing a voter rights registration drive, right? Win or lose, I think we need people that are out there in the community. And
yeah.
I think when you're talking, when you're telling people to organize, I wonder if you get down a little bit more granular and tell them how they can participate, right?
Yeah.
Everyone has power. And what's important is regardless of the label, right? Or the credential or the lack of credential that people understand beyond self-love that they have power.
Wow. And say your name again so folks will know it.
It's Talanya Adams.
Talanya Adams. And you're from here in Phoenix?
I was born in South Phoenix, Arizona.
Oh, wow. So this is home.
Yes.
Wow. So let me say this first of all. What's been amazing to me, and I don't know if it's a result of Donald Trump getting elected in 2016 and a combination of the Me Too movement, which was started by a black woman, my friend Tarana Burke, 10 years ago, we need to say 12 years ago, I need to say that, is the record number of women running for office all around the country. And I think it's incredible. I think that's absolutely incredible. The record number of transgender and queer folks running for office, et cetera, because it says that people understand that they have power. And I hope that you do it again, because we actually need people like you. You know, people have asked me if I'm going to do it again. People try to encourage me. I would have to get permission from my wife. So that's because you know, I mean, you're exposed when you run for office. It's not a game. But what can you do? That's a brilliant suggestion. Hey, I may not be able to vote, but I can certainly run for office. But I would actually say we need to learn how to run for office. We need to, would you agree, like the understanding the political apparatus? And I mean, she was talking about signatures. For those who don't know, it's like you have to get petitions signed to get on the ballot all around the country. And that's actually a particular kind of skill set, because it means you got to be able to talk to people. You know, I remember when I was running for office in 2008, 2010, having to go door to door, be at subway stations because it was New York, go anywhere that people were to try to get them to support it. And she's right. People would say, I'm formerly incarcerated. Folks would ask me questions like, in 2008, they would ask me, what are you going to do for me? And then I realized that by 2010, I switched it around. I said, well, what are we willing to do together to change this community? You know what I mean? We started doing things like needs assessments. And so someone might say, well, I'm a single mother and I need childcare. So we'd take notes and say, okay, let's make sure we refer this person to this. Someone said, well, I don't know where to go for my child to have a free summer camp. Well, like, let's call the Bedford-Stuyvesant Brooklyn YMCA and make sure that this child gets in there. There's so many ways that y'all can get involved. How many of y'all are active in the community in which you live? Okay. That's where we start. I would say part of organizing, being a leader, is assessing what skills I actually have. And that includes if you decide to run for office. What I realized in 2008, the first time I ran, I'm like, I'm good at talking to people. I suck at fundraising. I am terrible at that. You know what I mean? I had to get over that. By 2010, I'm like, I gotta pick up this phone and I gotta call people or I'm not gonna raise any money. It's really that simple. And so, you know, you're asking me what we can do. I mean, I can go through a litany of grassroots organizing stuff that we can do. It's like, you know, how do you network? How do you register people to vote? What does voter education look like? Do I know how to do a workshop around voter education? You know, do I need to know how to organize around formerly incarcerated persons? Do I know how to organize around folks who may be the victims of survivors of domestic violence? You know, what is it that I love to do? My wife is gonna be organizing something in October, which is called, her show is called She, a Choreo Play, which is going to be making its debut off Broadway next summer in New York, which is incredible. But she realized from doing the show off Broadway that there's so many women who have come out and said, you know, issues of healing and empowerment. So she's doing a whole day, organizing a whole day for women of all backgrounds. Am I right? Am I getting this right? You know, how do we heal? How do we empower ourselves? We're telling these stories, hashtag Me Too, hashtag Time's Up. But ladies, how do we move from victims and survivors to victors? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so, like, what are the tools that we need? So I would even say sometimes it might mean organizing the community. Like, what is it that we need? What do we actually need here? You know, that's what I was saying. Identifying a certain issue. For her, it's women's empowerment. So what is it for y'all in the community that you feel that your community needs the most, wherever you live? Does that make sense?
That's perfect sense. Yes, thank
okay.
you.
Okay.
Thank you.
And I hope you run again. You know, and let's stay in touch, please.
Yes.
You know, because as I said, we knew Andrew way back. Was he in student government at FAMU as well? I mean, this is crazy. And to see y'all flourishing in these places, And I just think if you really want to do it, you got to come back and do it again, you know? And I believe that we need younger, more dynamic leadership with a certain kind of value system for the community. And then as a lawyer, we know you got some skill sets. You know what I'm saying?
Thank you.
Thank you. We are done.
Don't go anywhere. It's not over. Don't go anywhere. I mean, wow. Can we have another standing ovation for Mr. Kevin Powell? I mean, he did amazing. Like, talking about intellect, being involved, information, amazing. So, on behalf of the NAACP/BSU branch of Phoenix College, myself, Lima Jenkins, as a student, also as the treasurer of the BSU, and Richard would like to present Mr. Powell with a token of appreciation for presenting this evening. Thank you so much again.
Let's grab my water. I'm out of here. And I love free stuff.
We have one more. Yeah, we got one more.
Sorry.
Hello, my name is Davion Maurice Duhart. I'm an honors student and a...
Honors student. Round of applause.
Yeah. I'm an honors student and I also play football here at Phoenix College.
What position?
Right now I'm playing linebacker and DN.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm 17 years old. I just graduated not too long ago. On behalf of the Men's Association, I'd like to give you a gift as well.
I didn't know any of this was down here. I never looked.
Yes, Pete.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
No problem.
Appreciate you.
Hey, but I do have one more question. I got a question. I don't care if it's on the mic or...
You want to ask it here?
All right, I ain't going to lie. I'm a little nervous. I kind of got put on the spot. I didn't know I was here, but I do have one question. And my question basically is, I didn't want to ask this question because it would come off as maybe selfish, and you just talked about being like selfless and stuff like that or whatever. But I'm someone who wants to be successful, and I measure success as financial freedom. And I want to obtain that financial freedom to make a change in the world because people with money have power, and that's usually how it goes. So I'm not asking you how to be successful, but more on what can I do to leave my name, leave an imprint on the people that I come across and someone make a change little by little to basically get to where I want to be in the future.
Oh, wow. Can I slide in here? Wow. Give him a round of applause for that question. Wow. So, 25, someone's gonna buy books for 10 of the students here tonight, which is beautiful. Okay. That's dope, wow, appreciate it. So, let me, say your first name again for me.
Davion.
Davion. Can I answer the question really quickly? I actually think that the most valuable thing you have is your mind. I do believe that. I do think that, you know, I certainly don't want to, and I said this twice today to people, Brother Davion, I don't want to die broke the way Dr. King and Malcolm X both did, giving their lives to the communities. I do think we should have as much financial freedom as we can. But I would say that, you know, we cannot measure power just by finances, you know what I mean? Because when you think about Dr. King, he may have only had 3 or 4 suits, but I can tell you for a fact, I've been around the world where that man's impact has been global, you know what I'm saying? Just because of the brilliance of his vision of what he did with the Civil Rights Movement. You feel what I'm saying? You know, and so I think that it should be multiple things. And there's nothing wrong with wanting to have power if it's used, if it's rooted in love, you know, and it's used to uplift other people. When it's only for ourselves, that's the problem. I look at LeBron James, and there's people out there for really profound reasons I can't understand. I hate LeBron. I love LeBron. Here's someone whose mother was only 15 when he was born. She raised him by herself, single mother, and this young man is now making sure that thousands of young people from his community in Akron are going to college, and he's also making sure that the parents get a second chance at an education as well, like Phoenix College is giving people a second chance. That's success to me. You know, it's not about his 3 championships. It's not about him being possibly the first billion-dollar athlete, is the fact that he's giving back, reaching back to other people and helping other people. That's the real measure of success. How many lives are you touching? You know, when Barack Obama was elected 10 years ago, he said the same answer to a question that myself and I'm sure many other men have said and women have said. The most important book to him is the autobiography of Malcolm X. Even though Malcolm X may not have died with a lot of money in his pockets either, you know, just the way Dr. King didn't, he left behind something that has touched so many lives. That's success. You understand what I'm saying? You know, you're saying you're a football player. I did an interview with Michael Bennett, who played for the Seahawks for years. He's now with the Philadelphia Eagles. My wife was there. When we sat there, when I sat there and did that interview with Michael Bennett, he had a book come out earlier this year. Here's someone who's won a Super Bowl. This man is a million-dollar athlete. But he used his platform to talk about, being, you know, about the Me Too movement. He cried, am I right? As a man, he showed vulnerability. And he said, I want to be an ally, a good ally to women and girls. That's success to me. Because he could just be focused on, I just want another Super Bowl. You feel what I'm saying? It's not just about money, you know what I mean? It's not just about money. Money can help you do certain things, you know, yeah, but at the end of the day, this is the most valuable tool. Am I right, Dr. Johnson? This is the most valuable tool. Am I right, Dean Thompson, Ms. Hicks? You know, everyone, this is the most powerful thing you could ever have is your mind, because once you have an education, you keep learning. No, can anyone take that away from you? Can anyone take that away from y'all? You know, learning is the most powerful tool that you could ever have. You know, I may not be a multimillionaire, but man, I have been blessed because of what I've been able to learn to travel around this world. You know what I mean? I didn't get on a plane until I was 24 years old because I didn't know that it was even possible. But once I got exposed to stuff, I was like, once my mind opened, I'm like, I'm never going to stop. I want to keep learning. I want to keep learning. You know what I mean? Money comes and goes. I don't want to be poor. I don't want to struggle for the rest of my life. But I, at the end of the day, what gives me the most excitement is last night, I'm trying not to get emotional. There's a single mother named Shay who just ran for office, city council in San Jose, California. She did something very profound that touched me. She sent me a picture of her son reading that book, and I posted it on social media. And then Shay hit me on Facebook Messenger, and she said, can I put my son on to talk to you? He's 13 years old. And when it was over, you know, she said, I just wanted my son, because he doesn't have any male role models, to just be able to talk to you. And it meant a lot to him. And I started crying on the inside, because, you know, I didn't have anybody like that when I was 13 years old. That's more powerful. That's more powerful. To be a role model, to touch young people, young males especially, who don't have role models. You know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? That's the most powerful thing you can do, man, you know, to be accessible to people, you know, who need you. You know what I mean? It's not about money, man. It's not about money. Because think about all the people who didn't have fathers there consistently. And the one thing that I keep hearing from folks whose fathers was there sometimes, it's like, I didn't want his money. What I wanted my father to do was to show up. To show up. That's what power is. When you see those images, we're going to see it next week on the East Coast as people are going back to school, of all these black and Latino males that are showing up at schools as kids are going to school, so our kids can see that black and Latino males in our communities care about these black and Latino communities. Y'all know what I'm talking about? That's power. You know what I mean? That's what I'm talking about. And so think about it like that. Yeah, get your money. You know, no one wants to be poor. But at the same time, you know, success is not just individual. It's like, how am I touching lives here? How am I impacting lives? Am I doing something that's going to matter to somebody else? And that little boy, 13-year-old boy, Joshua, you know, he's going to remember, you know, that we had that exchange when he's a grown man. You know what I mean? Just like I remember when I was 22 years old, an older man said to me something had never been said to me before, Kevin Powell, you are Prince. You are Prince. And years later, I called that man and thanked him. Because no one had ever said that to me. That's what power is. That's what success is. He saw something in me I didn't even see in myself. You feel me? Thank y'all.